Are we live?
We're live.
The mics are hot.
The mics are hot.
They're hotter than ever. This is a special edition of the Big Brown Breakdown. I'm your host, Brendan Schaub, and I got my friends here, Glenn Holmes and Tony Jeffries, the boxing experts from Box and Burn.
Yes.
What's happening?
I got you guys here for a number of reasons that we're going to get to.
Yeah, I can't wait.
We're definitely, I know you guys jumped in the bit. Me too, man. One of the reasons I want to do this is because every morning I have the same routine. I wake up with my son, make sure he's good, go downstairs. I'll watch my sports talk shows and ESPN First Take. I'll watch Dan Patrick. I'll watch all of them, man. I don't really mess with Undisputed because it's so lame. It's just not my thing because we'll get into that. But so I watch all of them. And then I see these guys just writing the fight off and saying, "No, it's not real. This is a gimmick." Dan Le Batard was like, "You know, this is just they're basically honey dicking everyone, hoodwinking people. If you're gonna buy this fight, it's just a spectacle. It's not real." And I'm watching all this, and I see all. And I think what's happening is the old boxing heads, which everyone is at all these networks, they don't know MMA. So all these old boxing heads, they feel like MMA's coming in disrespecting the sport, and that, you know, if this is all that's left, then boxing's dead and all this stuff. My issue with all this is, and that's why when I saw Max Kellerman, and it pissed me off, man. When I saw Max Kellerman go, "Listen, I can," and Max Kellerman is, I respect him the most out of any boxing analyst. He's a beast, head of HBO boxing team, all that stuff. And then obviously he's on First Take with Stephen A. Smith. When I saw him say, and this, he's an educated dude. I think he went to Yale or some shit. He's a Ivy League dude, smart guy, knows boxing better than anyone. And when he goes, "I guarantee you Conor McGregor won't land a punch." Yeah, you would have thought that. He slapped my baby. My shit, I took offense now. Like, oh, hell no. And then that's when I was like, yo, not only will he touch him, he will win at least one round. I can guarantee he wins at least one round. Unless the judges fuck him over. But because it's boxing commission, it's in Las Vegas, and Floyd Mayweather has those guys on his bankroll, then maybe he's screwed. But I guarantee you, Conor McGregor touches him. I will bet my entire life savings on it. That's just stupid. That's like saying, oh, Michael Phelps isn't going to get wet when he jumps in the pool. He's going to get wet. The other problem I have with it, so I bet Max Kellerman $100,000 that Conor wins a round and will touch him. Obviously, the touching one's a joke, but he will win a round. People will be surprised. The other thing is people go, it's like a soccer player jumping in playing baseball. No, it's not, you fucking morons. It is not like that. It's a combat. Both of them are part of combat sports, mixed martial arts. Boxing is part of mixed martial arts. Conor has sparred endless and endless rounds in boxing. Not to the level of Floyd Mayweather, but still combat sport. They're still punching each other in the face. It's like one does the breaststroke. They're both in the fucking water. One does the breaststroke. The other does the backstroke. That's a better analogy than baseball to rugby or what the fuck these idiots on Fox and ESPN are comparing it to. And also, I respect Matt Kellerman, so my fans, I see it on there. I don't need you guys to disrespect him. You guys don't have to call him a moron or whatever you want to call him. You don't need to do all that. Like, you can, the bet, and that's fun. I don't need you to disrespect any of those guys. They know what they know, and they're uneducated about Conor McGregor. This other thing, that night of the fight, there's only one man that walks into that ring who's a finisher, and his name's not Floyd Mayweather. Conor McGregor, and I'm sure you want to get this because you've had 1,000 boxing fights and clearly have brain trauma, but the thing is Conor McGregor's the only finisher there. When Conor McGregor fights in the UFC, I was a Golden Gloves boxer, which isn't to the level of you or a pro boxer, but I've had some boxing experience. I've had experience in mixed martial arts at the very highest level in the world. The pressure and the margin for error in a UFC fight is so much higher than a boxing fight, especially at 147 or 154 pounds before Floyd Mayweather fights. When Conor goes into that fight and he's fighting a bigger guy, Eddie Alvarez, who's, you know, he's a Hall of Famer. When he fights Chad Mendes, when he fights Jose Aldo, who's one of the best strikers in the history of combat sports, boxing, kickbox, tape, whatever you want to do. And he hasn't lost in 10 years, and he starches him in 13 seconds. You know how many ways Conor can lose to that man opposed to Floyd Mayweather fighting Berto or whoever, or Shane Mosley or Canelo? You know how many ways he can lose to Jose Aldo? Through kicks, punches, elbows, ground and pound, submission. He has a million ways to lose, and he still shows up and passes the fucking test every single time on the biggest stage against guys he probably shouldn't be beating, that no one gave him a shot for. He goes up in weight class. Then he fights a guy named Nate Diaz at 170 pounds. He fights at 145 pounds. He fights a guy who walks around about 190. He loses to him, or loses because he never fought at that weight, and everyone wants to say, oh, he got outstruck by Nate Diaz. That does not matter. That is an MMA fight at that weight class. That is not the same. The distance is different. We'll get into that. Why I think Conor's actually going to be successful in this fight. So he fights a guy at 170. He's cutting down from 190. Wins rounds and then ends up losing, right? His first fight, he gets choked out. First loss in the UFC. Dana White and his management go up to this kind of guy Conor is. Goes up to him and goes, hey, man, if you're going to fight Nate Diaz again, has to be at 55. Conor goes, nope.
Yeah, I love that.
Nope. He goes, dude, it has to be at 55. He goes, not happening, man. The only fight I want is at 70. I want to prove to people I can pass this test. Beats him in five rounds. He ends up beating him in five. Now, if it went a sixth round, he might have been in trouble. I don't give a fuck about any of that. Knocks him down multiple times, beats him in five rounds. Then goes to 55 and fights Eddie Alvarez. The whole point here is one of these guys is fighting with insane, insane pressure. And he's a finisher. One of them is not. You watch Floyd Mayweather's last three fights and tell me he's fighting for a finish. Fuck you. You watch his last 10 fights. Tell me he's fighting for a finish. And he's a counter puncher. He's not a pressure fighter. Conor knocks guys going out backwards, forwards. So this whole thing here where everyone goes, Conor doesn't have a chance. Floyd Mayweather's best of all time. Let's talk about that. Floyd Mayweather, he hasn't fought in 4 years. He has brittle hands, 2 years. He has 2 years. Brittle hands, age isn't on his side. He's a counter puncher. He's a safe fighter. He's going to coast and win rounds. Do you guys think he's going to change his whole dynamic just to pressure and try and knock out Conor? Definitely not. He's going to be the same exact fighter. He's going to be the same exact fighter that we've all come to know and some people hate or whether you love him. This is why this fight is interesting, and this is what people are waiting for. In boxing, you know this better than anyone, Tony. Boxing, the distance, the striking distance is very close. You don't fight from a distance. In MMA, the distance is crazy. It's about from me to fucking Glenn right now in this studio. It's far. It's very far, and your stance is narrow. Floyd Mayweather grew up. How many fights has he had? He's fought. He's seen every style. The one time we saw him struggle as of late was in a brawling style against Maidana. Because Maidana's not your traditional. He's a brawler. Gets in your face. He's awkward making it nasty. It's awkward. You know, what the fuck? What Mayweather needs is a precise guy like Shane Mosley, Canelo, a guy he's seen before. He can read, get out, do his thing. Conor McGregor is the exact opposite of that. And he's also the biggest guy he's ever fought. And I hate to tell you, he's quicker than all these guys he's fought. He's quicker than Canelo. His speed is better than Canelo. His left hand is better than Canelo's. I promise you, he is, man. I promise. His power is better than Canelo's.
Nah.
Let's go for who has more knockouts. But this is the problem. It's a different sport. Yeah. But let me just go back to that. The other thing in boxing is if we're against the ropes, I can stand here, right?
Yeah.
I can do this all day, do this. And then Mayweather's always tying guys up, right? Tie Conor McGregor up. Fucking tie that. Let me know how your underhook goes against a world-class mixed martial artist. You're not going to get rest there. Mixed martial artist is going to get you against cage. We're going to get an underhook, which we can do in boxing, heavy on the head. That will not be Mayweather's rest at all. Conor McGregor's the bigger guy. He's going to have a size advantage. But also, the thing that makes this fight so interesting is that distance between where we fight. For Conor McGregor, we're used to it. This is the world we live in. This is my backstroke. For you, you gotta figure out what I'm going to do. The distance will be different. How many rounds is it going to take Floyd Mayweather to figure out that distance? In a live situation, where on pay-per-view, where the lights are hot, how many rounds is it going to take? And you say, well, he's figured out before, not this equation before. Not maybe, he might be fishing. Now you're fishing with fucking fish with lasers on their heads. It's going to take a little bit for you to get used to that.
Yeah.
So what's going to happen is he's going to figure it out. He's the best. He's one of the best of all time. He's going to figure it out. The issue here is how many rounds? Is it going to be 6 rounds? Be 10 rounds? Is it going to be 2 rounds? I don't know, but it's going to take him time. In those rounds, Conor will win a few of those rounds if the commission doesn't fuck him over. And to the point of this is TJ Dillashaw sparred Lomachenko. Lomachenko's the pound for pound number one on everyone's list. Lomachenko's numero uno. I just watched fucking Homeboy last night on HBO. He gave his list, and Lomachenko's number Lomachenko, bottom line, is number one on everything.
Yeah.
Lomachenko, TJ Dillashaw sparred. Now, TJ Dillashaw, as talented as he is, is not unconventional and not as talented as Conor McGregor. This is what it is. TJ, you know I love you if you're listening to this. It took Lomachenko at least 4 rounds in sparring with no pressure to pick up the timing, the distance, the angles of TJ Dillashaw.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what tape can you watch on Conor McGregor to pick up those angles, all that, in boxing? Now, you're going to tell me, and we'll get to this, that Chris Van Heerden tape? We can get to that. That's fake, man. That's bullshit. That's not real. That's like watching a fucking walkthrough in the NFL going, oh my God, these guys are, look, Tom Brady's missing passes. In practice, bitch, it's not real. That's not real time. You cannot evaluate his boxing skills off that. That's that is not a real situation.
But that's all we've got to go off.
That's all you have to go off of.
That's all we've got.
That's not real.
Let me ask you one question. How will Conor win a round? How will he win a round against Floyd Mayweather?
How's he going to win around?
Yeah.
He's going to be so much longer. His jab's going to land. Early on, it's going to land from different angles. But this is the other thing.
I mean, which angle can you throw a different jab from?
Our angles in MMA are going to be different. Because look, our boxing stance, and hopefully the camera can fucking see this. Our boxing stance is like this, right? We can generally tell where the dynamics and all the boxing is going to come from in this angle. Conor is going to fight like this. He's going to fight like this. The jab's going to be here, here. But he's going to be here.
But when
here.
He's like that.
And then also when we're close, what is Floyd Mayweather going to do when we're close?
But when you're up like that, the head's in the same position?
Not really. Not Conor. If you've seen him, seen the way he's moved. He moved. I'm saying he's seen the position.
So what you're saying is you think Conor was going to outbox Floyd?
No.
A little bit.
He's going to out-awkward him. He's going to out-awkward
him. If you're out-jabbing him, you're out-boxing him.
Different jab.
But so that means he's out-boxing him.
I wouldn't say out-box him. I'm not saying he's going to out-jab the fuck out of him. I'm saying he's going to lap some jabs at Floyd. He's going to adjust quick. So he's going to be like, oh, fuck, I didn't realize he was that quick.
I love Conor McGregor. I'm a massive fan. And I don't like Floyd. And I'd love to see him fucking beat him. But I just think he's got no chance. And like Max Kellerman said, he might land a few punches, but I can't see him winning
around. No, Max Kellerman said he would land no punches.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. The thing is, right, with the Max Kellerman comment, you've took that literally. You've took it word for word. He said he's not going to land one punch.
It's no different than if I say Conor McGregor's going to win every round. You're going to take that pretty literal.
Right.
I think he's going to win some rounds.
Yeah.
Landing no punches.
So let's break it down. How will he win a round? You said, his distance.
He's going to bully him.
He's
going to bully him the way Maidana did. He's going to bully him for a little bit.
Nah, of course. He's going to get caught when he goes in. Because Conor gets hit as well. Even when he fought Jose Aldo, he landed that punch straight away. He got caught at the same time.
While knocking him out. I think we'll take that. Real quick, let me ask you this. Floyd Mayweather lands a right hand. Conor McGregor lands a left hand. Flush. Who gets knocked out in this situation?
I don't think Floyd can knock him out. I think...
Fucking Conor's tough.
I think he can.
Conor's come tough. On, Tony.
That fight's not going to go the distance.
No. I agree.
I'll bet with you right
now. What do you want to bet? I've got a lot of money out there with the 100 grand on backs and 10 grand going to the distance.
Let's put $2,000 on it.
So
that doesn't go the distance.
All right.
Right. So
$2,000?
Yeah.
No, wait. So you're my boy. I'm going to take the money.
I'm going to charge interest. I know where you live.
I'm going to give you the money.
Yeah, I'm going to show up to your gym and punk you in front of people.
So there's 2 G's on that. That fight doesn't go the distance.
Deal.
Yeah.
So I think the most likely outcome is Mayweather on points. I do think the most likely scenario goes the distance. I think Conor's so tough and used to the MMA world where you just get, it's so much more intense.
It's a tougher life,
in terms of the punishment.
The odds are higher. Definitely.
So I think if Mayweather lands clean on me, he could probably take his power all day. But I was interested in clip. Errol Spence was talking about sparring Mayweather, and he was saying that his power is really unpredictable and varied when he spars.
Yeah, I bet.
He'll tap jabs, stick one in stiff. It's very rare that every shot is very heavy all the time, so he varies up the power. But I think Conor would have no problem taking his best.
I think it goes the distance, and especially if it goes to the judges. No matter if Conor won, if it's a close fight, Conor's not winning that fight with that boxing commission. He's not. I can guarantee both of you this, and I would bet my last dollar on it. If there is a finish, it's because Conor McGregor knocked him out. Name the last finish Floyd had.
But name the last time Floyd got knocked out or dropped.
With his style, there's no risk. There's no risk. Why would he?
He fought Manny Pacquiao, one of the best.
With one arm. Manny had one arm. He had one fucking arm and old as fuck, and he's also running the Philippines at the same time.
But look at all the other. Look at his last 10 opponents.
I look at him. And look at the way he fought.
Look at Miguel Cotto fucking.
Oh, you got Miguel Cotto.
I just think, like,
but still, come on, man.
The argument.
But look at the way he's fighting him. He's not risking anything.
But that's smart. That's why he's undefeated.
I agree. It's brilliant.
You know what I mean?
It doesn't make him a finisher.
He doesn't need to prove puncher. He doesn't need to go in there and go, I'm going to fight and fucking knock this guy out. It's like, so that's not what boxing's about. That's the difference. In MMA, there's pressure to deliver knockouts and be aggressive and put a show on.
Yep.
You know, there's pressure in MMA on that. In boxing, there's no real pressure for that. And to a degree, agreed. I think that's part of the reason why MMA's done a lot better over the last few years.
Because of the violence.
So there's no real pressure on fighters to knock their opponents out.
There's only one real finisher in that ring on August 20, and it's August 26, and it's not Floyd Mayweather. There's only one real killer in there who's out to prove something.
See,
one of them's in their prime. One of them's an old 40-year-old man with hand issues. And money issues.
I mean, his hands should be better now. I'd like fucking 3 years off.
You know how it is. Yeah, you have hand issues.
That's true. That's true. But I think what you're forgetting is Floyd Mayweather is a hard bastard. He's from the fucking ghetto. Yeah, he's got all this money, but he's a hard, horrible bastard.
Conor McGregor, let's just go over this. Conor McGregor, 4 years ago, cashed a welfare check for $200.
4 years ago?
4 years ago.
Fucking hell.
He's going to make $100 million.
I love that. Do you know what?
He's a hard bastard too. Oh, from totally. Fucking 100%, Dublin. 100%. Those motherfuckers are rough.
Yeah, it is.
This is what's so interesting about this fight. I think more than the fight itself, the build-up's going to be the best thing ever. The best. You got sort of fucking hard as fuck Irish crew going up against old Mayweather. It's just like the thought.
It's going to be great. This is my issue when the mainstream media goes, "It's a shit fight. You guys are getting hoodwinked." Hold on. And we're going to break it down, but you got freaking Andre Ward versus Kovalev, this weekend's two light heavyweights ranked top five in the world overall, pound for pound.
Yeah.
No one's talking about it. Because what America and what the world cares about is entertainment.
Yes.
That's why this fight is so big. No one's getting hoodwinked. Mm-hmm. Everyone wants to know what's going on here. No one's getting screwed. It's not a circus act. It's nothing like that.
Yeah.
There is a chance, you got to admit this, Tony, that if Conor McGregor in some weird fashion lands that left hand that has starched some of the very best in the world in mixed martial arts, if that lands, Floyd Mayweather he's going to get knocked out.
I mean, I hope it does land and I hope he does knock him out. 100% not happening, but I hope
if
it does.
If he did, is it the end of boxing?
Nah, football.
No. You don't think so?
No.
Nah.
Because then I think the Mayweather will be like, well, the arguments will be, oh, he was shot, he was too old, whatever. He didn't take him seriously.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm friends with tons of boxers and I'm following them on social media. One thing that I'm surprised at is how many boxers are hating on this fight.
Mm. All of them.
What the fuck?
But so is MMA, though, a little bit. Like,
oh, really?
I look at MMA. Like some of my favorites, like Luke Thomas, you know, Ariel Helwani for a long time said it was a joke. Like all guys I look up to are the guys, you know, who are my peers, who I look for news for. I see them like, what are you guys doing, man? We fucking arrived. We have the biggest star in the world competing against boxing, number one pound for pound. Like, oh, it's a gimmick. This is fake. I'm like, what bullshit. The fuck?
You got the biggest superstar in MMA going up against the biggest superstar in boxing. How is that not interesting? If you're a fan of either sport in any capacity, at any level, whether you're a casual fan or you're a fucking boxing or MMA, like, hardcore fan, like, I don't get how you're not excited about it. I think there's a lot of bitterness. It's just
exactly. I think there's jealousy. A lot. And I said, get ready for all the experts because they're older and they don't know mixed martial arts and they don't know the capabilities of a guy like Conor McGregor. They just don't know. So they're going to write that off. And then you have the fighters, whether it's boxing or MMA, just going, oh, this is ridiculous. Because it's a jealousy factor that they're not there.
Yes. So the big one with that was Oscar De La Hoya. He even wrote a letter to the commission to see...
Don't sanction the fight, right?
Reason is because he's jealous as fuck. If it was him fighting Floyd Mayweather, he would be all over it.
Here's the thing with fucking Oscar De La Hoya. You know, well, you remember it was kind of up in the air. We didn't know it was going to go. Oscar De La Hoya offered Canelo. He wanted Canelo. Right. You want Canelo, Conor McGregor. And now that it doesn't work out for him, he's saying Dana White this and Dana White that. I'm like, fuck you, Oscar. Go put on some fucking high heels. You know what I'm saying? Go put on some high heels and do a line of coke and stay out of our business.
I'll tell you what.
Because before, you're all about it.
Yeah.
And that, and now, just because Canelo and Triple G do a fraction of what fucking Floyd Connor does, you're all up in a fucking bunch.
You know, only about 2 weeks ago, someone predicted that was going to be the biggest boxing pay-per-view of all time, and it was going to eclipse Mayweather Pacquiao.
Canelo Triple G?
Not a chance now.
No, not a chance. Nor was it ever. Come on, man. I'm excited for that fight. It's the best fight in boxing in a long time.
Yeah.
But Canelo, or I'm sorry,
they're screwed.
Yeah, Mayweather Connor is such a... It's the biggest sports spectacle of our lifetime, man. Yeah. It's fucking huge.
So why are people hating? The thing is, like, why the fuck are you hating on it? If it's going to ever happen,
it's easy.
Let's hate on it. Let's not hate on it. It's going to happen. Let's have it happen in our lifetime. Do you know what I mean?
People have been talking about this forever.
Right.
Forever.
And the thing is, people, the comments I've read, it's all directed at Mayweather, like, fuck Mayweather, he's ruining the legacy of boxing and he's tarnishing his reputation. I'm like, okay, if he doesn't take the fight, you're going to hammer him for being a fucking pussy.
Yep.
And then if he does take the fight, you're going to give him shit for taking the fight.
And also,
either way, he's not going to win.
But you got to remember, like, and I respect, I like both fighters, but you got to remember with Floyd, he's risking his entire legacy on this X Factor guy. Like, it's not the easiest fight in the world.
It's unpredictable.
Like a Cotto or a fucking Pacquiao rematch, that's easy for him.
Right.
This is this weird kind of, he's gonna make a ton of money, but you're dealing with a guy you've never really seen before. And I hate to tell you guys there, but in that ring, August 26th, the best athlete ain't Floyd Mayweather either. Conor is a better athlete than Floyd Mayweather.
Yeah, I agree with that.
He's a better athlete.
Yeah, I agree.
All around athlete, not boxer.
I thought we were about to argue.
One of the things I'm most excited about is the first press conference. I think Conor's going to destroy him mentally. I think so because...
Not mentally.
Mentally, it's going to be tough to get to Floyd.
No, because...
Unless he talks about his assault charges.
I don't think Mayweather has faced anyone with this kind of mentality since Ricky Hatton. Somebody who's just going there, who does not respect him, does not give a fuck about him, right?
Ricky Hatton got dealt with.
He got dealt with, obviously, but in the build-up... In the build-up, it was one of the best. It was one of the best
Ricky
ever.
Ricky Hatton's career, right?
Right, and it really, like, built the fight. Like, can't do it. Yeah, and I think McGregor's just going to go in there with that I don't give a fuck mentality. Half of the opponents that he's had since then, Mayweather, they've been beaten when they get to the press.
I agree. And so, some of Conor's too. This is one of the reasons I wanted you guys in here, obviously, because you guys know boxing like a motherfucker. But Chris Van Erden, who I like, and he's the guy, he's on TMZ Sports right now, says Mayweather will destroy you. Conor's boxing sparring partner. So when at my live shows in Australia, people would ask about, I get asked about Conor Floyd more than anything in the world now, even before all this. So now it's even crazier. But everyone goes, look out when Conor sparred that, you know, that average guy at boxing, burn your gym in California. I mean, he got tuned up. I'm like, that's not real, man. So can you tell us, like, what was going on there? Because it's not like Conor came in and was like, hey, Tony, line up a sparring partner. I'm going to go balls to the wall sparring. And also, make sure everyone records it.
Well, you
were there for this first spar, right?
Yeah. So when they came in, they were just coming to take over. And they're like, have you got anyone we can move around with?
Conor did.
Yeah. And they wanted to move around with a sparring partner. And Chris Van Erden, he was there. So
I don't mean to interrupt you, but... Move around with.
Right.
Move around with. Not, do you have anyone I can fucking go crazy on and then we'll try and knock me out and I'll knock them out? And can we have everyone in the gym record it so this gets blasted out?
Yeah. One thing I was surprised about was with the recording, how they let people record it. And then the
whose idea was it to record?
Well, they had all the cameras.
Because when I saw it, you know, because when you said Connor's coming to the gym, I went, perfect, man. This is great for the gym. You know, obviously, I love Connor. I love you guys. I'm like, this is great, man. And then when I saw the video, I texted you, I went, who in the fuck filmed that? Because you know how it is. As when I was a fighter, you're a boxer, there was no cameras.
Yeah.
I don't want that getting out because, i.e., look at the fuck. This is why you don't want that getting out.
I mean, when
you could be working on something and someone films it and they go, look at Chob, his left hand's down. It's like, well, no, I'm working with.
Yeah, I mean, I remember those times when you were sparring and I'd have to stop the spar and say, listen, put your phone away and tell them, you know. Yeah, you don't want that shit. So I was surprised that they allowed this, but they had all them people filming. Everyone in the gym was filming it. I was like, fucking hell, this is crazy. And then I had TMZ on the phone to me all the time. Can we have some of this footage? Can we have some of the footage in your gym? And I was like, not a fucking chance.
Said no,
not a chance. And then I was talking to Connor's manager, Ari, and I said, mate, we've got TMZ, people in England, everyone wanting some footage of the sparring. He went, well, if you've got any, give them it. He says, but don't give them it directly. Put it on your social media. So we put it on a clip of them sparring on Box and Burn Instagram, on Box and Burn YouTube. And then within an hour, that Ari phoned us and he said, it's Ari, right? Ari called us and he was like, Tony, need to take that down. I didn't realise you were going to put the clip of them spawning on. And I went, well, that's what you said, the spawn. He went, yeah, sorry, mate, my bad, my mistake. Can you take it down? So I took it down.
Sounds like Adi fucked up.
Oh,
maybe he thought it was just mitts, or maybe he thought
it was spawning because we said that they want some of the footage spawning. He went, yeah, put a bit up. He said, tag Chris in it, tag Connor in it. And then within an hour, he told me to take it down. I took it down.
Too late.
Once it's out there, too late. Because within that hour, TMZ ripped the video, posted the video, and then it was on everyone's social
media.
It's
like if you blast a dick pic out, it's like, oh, my bad. Like, that's out in the world. Like, your dick is out there for the rest of your life.
The internet now. So now it's like every time I'm looking on social media, on Instagram, I'm scrolling, like, oh, shit, there's Box and Burn, which is like, I mean, it's not terrible for us. But
no,
like,
and Connor's come back because, again, and I want to make this clear, you guys weren't like secretly recording and released
No. Connor was there, it was like 3 or 4 weeks ago training. He loves the gym. And
yeah,
it's funny, I spoke to Artie again. I said, do you think I'll do some mitts with him because he hasn't got a trainer? He went, oh yeah, just ask him, he'll probably do some mitts with you. So I'm like, yes, I've got a chance to do some mitts with Conor McGregor. So he was hitting the heavy bag and I went over and then he was doing 5 minute rounds. Then the end of round one or whatever he was on ended, but then he kept punching. Then round two started and he kept punching. Right, all the way through, no breaks. I was there for fucking 15 minutes. I was like, I've got shit to do. Just never stopped, relentless, smashing the fuck out of that bag. He's a beast, mate. He's an absolute beast.
So I just think it's weird that people go, he can't box. Like, look at him against Chris Van Erden, who, you know, Chris is he a world champ?
A former world champ, yeah.
You know, he's IBO champ.
But he's a top IBO. But he's still, I think, top ranked in the top 15.
He's top 15 in IBF and WBA, I think.
Whatever the fuck, even if he's ranked number one, it does not matter, man. If you cannot take that footage, like I said, when guys they move around and they don't know each other, that none of that's live. That's just there to get some work, feel each other out. But everyone's putting so much weight on this video, which I actually think in the long run helps Connor.
Right, yeah, it does.
Because if this is all Mayweather has to go off of, enjoy that, man.
Tell you what, it was funny though, because Connor's team or whoever put a video out of Connor sparring this as well, this was later on. But they cut it to every time that Connor looked good. Like every time he slipped the punch, they cut it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And then that's when Chris started tweeting shit or whatever, putting shit out there as well.
Yeah, because Chris and them are trying to run with it now, which I don't, I mean.
Yeah, I mean.
I think
it's hard to get any publicity as a boxer unless you're, you know, top three guy.
He's getting great publicity, but
is
he's
he
complete.
Though?
Well,
oh, yeah,
on
I mean,
TMZ
yeah, he's
exclusive.
Getting more,
you know,
more publicity.
He's getting publicity, but he's right here on TMZ.
How would any other boxer get on TMZ?
But that's short-term gain. That's only short-term gain. Long-term, he screwed himself out of ever doing any sparring with Connor right?
Yeah, definitely.
I don't think they would have brought him in for the Floyd sparring because he's a southpaw, but that's definitely not happening
that
now.
That relationship's kind of gone.
Yeah.
But I'm glad that we still strong relationship with Connor and his team, so hopefully they'll come and train back in Boxing Burn when they're in LA
in town,
before this fight.
Yeah, see, I just think it's ridiculous. Like, you're not doing yourself any favor here. Again, I love Chris, but we asked straight up if Connor has a knockout power to beat Floyd. Van Erden's response, no. That's not true, Chris. That's not true. Connor's knocked out some of the very best mixed martial artists in the world.
But I think with that question as well, to knock out Floyd,
does he have power, though?
To knock him out.
Does he have the power?
To knock out Floyd.
He has more power than Floyd.
To knock out Floyd.
He's more of a knockout artist than Floyd in every way possible.
But what is it, 4 ounce gloves or 6 ounce gloves you wear?
Four ounce. But you know, 10-ounce boxing gloves ain't shit. Yeah, hate to tell you out there, 4-ounce to 10-ounce, right, when it comes to boxing and the way it goes around the hand, it's not that much of a difference.
They're fighting at 154 or 147?
154.
So it's going to be 10-ounce gloves.
It's 10-ounce gloves, yeah. And 154 is actually an advantage for Conor.
So we'll look at Conor's last 10 opponents, right?
Please look at it.
And then look at Mayweather's last 10 opponents. Now, if you take the MMA factor out of that and you put Conor's last 10 opponents in with Mayweather's last 10 opponents, I think their last 10 opponents would knock out every one of them in a boxing fight within a few rounds. And then, would they be the hardest puncher in the world, like the people seen about McGregor?
No, Conor, he's just this freak. He's this freak. My thing is, with that is, you know, with those guys you can't really do that. And I'm a guy who I like
well,
boxing.
That's what we do.
I'm
here.
A purist. We do it here, but I don't like Stipe versus Anthony Joshua. So Stipe Miocic is the UFC heavyweight champ, and then Anthony Joshua replied to him and said, "Who the fuck is this guy?" Like, joking around. I don't like any other UFC fighter or Bellator fighter fighting boxing. It's not good. It's not good for either sport. This is the only fight I like because of Conor's unorthodox style, because he's the king of mixed martial arts versus the king of boxing, and because Floyd is a counterpuncher, not a pressure puncher. Now, if you go Canelo versus Conor, I'm seeing a different tune right now. That fight does not go 12 rounds.
Right.
Conor probably gets finished.
Because it's the just, style difference.
It's the style difference. So it's the perfect style matchup and perfect name recognition for this magnitude of this biggest fight of our life.
Let's talk about the Conor Diaz 2 fight. What was the key in that fight? What won him that fight? It wasn't his boxing, it was his leg kick.
No, it was his boxing. He dropped them 3 times.
It was smashing that front leg to get him to drop his hands to throw the punches.
Still, it was that left hand over the top. And he also dropped the first time, too. He wobbled Nate Diaz, who's a much bigger dude. Like, that left hand can knock out bigger dudes, way bigger than Floyd Mayweather.
Yeah, but
does it land? I don't know, Tony. If it lands flush, it's trouble.
Yeah, but if Floyd lands flush on Conor, it's trouble.
I don't think so.
It is.
Not with his hands.
Just look at look how many people in 49 fights have landed flush on Floyd. Shane Mosley.
Yeah, and Shane Mosley, a fucking
Ortiz.
Puncher.
Not clean.
Shane Mosley hit him clean.
No, Mosley did, but not
Mosley wobbled him, yeah.
Yeah, and Shane Mosley's a hard puncher.
In 49 fights.
Yeah.
Yeah.
49 fights.
No,
I
get it.
You can think of one instance where he's took a clean shot.
I get it.
I get it.
You're talking standard boxing.
The thing I'd like to think, I just think, out of all the people that give the arguments, you're the only person that gives me a little bit of doubt and kind of creates a compelling argument for Conor, just based on the unpredictability factor. That's what makes it so interesting.
That's what
it's
I'm
the unknown.
Dying on.
It's the unknown, right? We don't know.
Yes.
We don't know. So that gives him the point, the argument. But I'm just thinking of people like Canelo, Juan Manuel Marquez, Miguel Cotto, Manny Pacquiao.
Best boxers.
These have
all
been fucking schooled by Floyd Mayweather. And they're not like average fighters. They're not even world level. They're fucking elite level. They're
elite,
all-time great.
Now, how would you
and
rank?
And Mayweather
rank,
just fucking schooled a lot
right?
of them.
He schooled all those top guys. Now, to your point, now how would you rank Maidana in that group? Right?
I'd say he's way below that.
Way below. And did Maidana not give him the most trouble?
Just because of the awkward factor. Looping punches that are coming around the
side.
but look at Ricky Hatton in his prime. Come forward, fighter, tough fucker, can fight in the inside. And when you see Floyd McGregor gets up inside close, what the fuck's he going to do? I know that Mayweather can't do anything inside.
Zero.
Like, it was like when you were spawning Ollie Harrison, Olympic champion, and Brendan got inside rim and you held him, and he was like, I've never been held at that before in my life.
But do you know what Ricky Hatton said about Mayweather? He said the biggest surprise out of that fight was how good Mayweather was on the inside. As soon as he got caught, boom, banging him on the hips.
But that's what Mayweather does.
And he said people don't think of him as an inside fighter. They see him as a rangy counterpuncher fighter.
Very Klitschko-esque, where you get close, they tangle you up, and they want to restart.
Right.
Yeah.
So Conor will tangle Mayweather up, but what the fuck's he going to do? He's not going to score any points. He's not going to hit him.
He's going to hit him there.
How?
Clinch is probably the most interesting part of the fight.
I promise you Conor's going to get that double dirty on him.
At wrestling, at turning and all that, but not landing punches, not working.
It's tough to get a clean one.
I mean, again, it is, but especially against Floyd.
Yeah.
So let's see if Conor's got him up tight there, what can he do? nothing that's going to get separated like it did with Hatton, and then they're going to have to go
but
again.
Who's going to be more worn out from that unusual way of tying up? Not Connor.
I don't
Floyd
think
is round after round.
That's so
look how fit Floyd is.
With his style, this is why he's fit. And people go, Connor's going to have an issue with the 12 rounds. You got to remember, Connor's gone with a bigger man at a heavier weight, 170 pounds, right? Those five-minute rounds. Yeah, but five-minute rounds is harder than 12 rounds.
You're an MMA fighter. You were. What is the hardest aspect of MMA fighting? Is it the wrestling, jiu-jitsu? Is it the boxing?
Depends what your specialty is, but But
generally?
The grappling's tough, man.
Yeah.
Grappling will wear your ass out.
I would imagine.
It's so exhausting. Mm. But also, grappling, if, let's say, I'm the grappler and you don't want to grapple, and I'm hanging on your head, I get the underhook, I'm doing that, it's legal in boxing, I'm giving you knee checks, I'm off balance, you're like, what the fuck, man? I can't get a... And when Floyd's like, this is usually where I get my rest, yeah, at least 8 to 12.
There's none of this shit in that.
There's checking.
Not, what were your knee?
Oh, yeah.
In boxing?
Oh, yeah.
Nah.
100%. I can do this. Stand up, dude.
Let's fucking do it, mate.
Look, if we're here and we're against the ropes, I can do this. I can bump you like that.
Yeah, you're
not, I'm not saying he's kicking him. I can do this.
You're not thinking the referee's going to get on that like that?
No.
100%. This is illegal in boxing.
That's not illegal.
It's illegal in boxing.
To this. This
is illegal in boxing.
That's not illegal.
That's illegal.
This is not illegal. ride you. And then look, I'm on your head here.
But then I'm walking like this.
That's fine. That's fine.
Then this,
you know what I'm saying? But that's not illegal for me to get leverage with my knees.
But then
you're dealing with an expert all night long for 12 rounds on the inside.
I can't fucking wait.
This is just building my excitement.
Mayweather is an expert inside as well
with traditional boxers, which it's really not part of the game, is it?
So you know in MMA when the referee comes
in. Stay on my face, bro.
When the referee comes in before and they talk to you and. You'll see it. Make sure, I'm sure it's the same in MMA.
Yeah, make sure he does this. Make sure he's not low blowing.
I think it was Mitt Romer was saying he does this or whoever.
Yeah, Mitt Romer was saying I grabbed the shorts or something like that. I forget what it is.
But not before the fight, you tell the referee, listen, make sure he
Watch
doesn't do
this.
Because he does it all the time.
Mm.
Or was someone anyway.
Now, what are you going to say for Connor? Make sure he does it.
No, what he's going to say, when he's inside, make sure he's not holding for too long because that's what he's going to do. He's going to try and be dirty on the inside. So the referee's going to be warned of Floyd Mayweather and fucking the team. He's going to be strictly warned.
But who does that? But
who's
Floyd's,
in charge?
That's Floyd's MO. That's what he does all the time.
Who's in charge of the officials for this?
He ties up on the inside.
No, he ties up, but then it breaks up. Because he doesn't want to be on the inside like Ricky Hatton. The referee
I'm
was
just
told.
Round
was,
that was Joe
round.
Cortez. Who
Joe Cortez.
Referee,
I'm just saying round after round, Connor getting the underhook, checking.
As soon as
heavy, heavy.
As soon as it's underhooked, it's broke up. Underhooked, broke up. 100%. Watch Floyd and Ricky.
At the beginning, it will be. And then and then Connor's getting head control. I'm telling you, man.
Touch with that head once, and he's going to start getting points took off him. Like, fucking that.
He might.
I'm telling you.
Yeah, he might get points taken away.
Yeah.
It's going to get dirty.
Do you know, I think it might get weird. Like, all the Ortiz fight got weird when he lost his cool and started throwing the heads in.
Headbutt.
And then, you know, I think we can expect to see some
Connor
kind of weird
shit. I think Connor would be prepared
for
all that shit as well.
100%.
Like, Floyd would be prepared for it as well. But yeah, I mean, what all that shit that you've just said there, that's the
X factor.
It's what, like, no one's explained that before. So if you're boxing front of you and you're listening to that, quite a bit of that, what he said, makes sense. Quite a bit of it.
It's legit point to it. No one's talking about. Like,
yeah,
these weird X factors where you're like, oh, yeah, the distance, the timing, the angles, the in close, the wearing them out. It's just.
Right.
Does skill level trump all of that, though? That's what I think.
Yes, it fucking does.
Skill level in what respect?
In boxing.
Boxing him, like moving, his reactions, his footwork.
He's 40, every bit of it too. He looks a black 40. There's a big difference when you look black 40 between white 40 or Asian 40. Like, how old do you think Chin is?
Chin, how old are you?
Chin looks 24 fucking years old. Chin is 48 years old.
Fucking hell.
Yeah. Koreans, Asians, you can't fucking tell. Black guys, you can't tell. Then all of a sudden, it's like Cinderella, midnight, boom, trolls. Floyd Mayweather looks, if you show me a mugshot of Floyd, I'd be like, oh, he's at what, 44, 45?
Is that Floyd Senior?
You know what I'm saying? Like,
oh, that tweet was fucking great by Connor, by the way.
Yeah,
Floyd Senior. But look at Bernard Hopkins when he was beating world champions until he was like 48.
True.
You know, and he was a beast. He never stopped, although Floyd's had the 2 year off, but Floyd's never been an active fighter.
He's a fighter.
That's true.
Yeah.
And he retired like about 6 years ago.
He seems to deal with the layoff pretty well.
Yeah, he does.
Because he picks and chooses when he fights. Yeah. Yeah.
But I mean, like we said, this build-up's going to be great. And I just hope that they don't get physical in the first one because that'll keep them apart for the rest of them. You know?
I don't think they do. I think they're both, because Conor's not a guy who gets physicals at the weigh-ins. He's, you know, he's a showman. He knows exactly what he's doing.
Yeah.
He's also not a scumbag.
He does get physical. He throws shit and fucking.
Well, no, that was different when they did. They threw stuff at him. That was a little different because they couldn't get to him. That was at a press conference for the whole UFC. But like, you know, he'll grab belts and make a scene, but he's not trying to get in a real fight. He's a showman to the fullest. Listen, the one thing about Conor is he's actually a good dude. And he knows exactly what he's doing to a T. Floyd Mayweather, he knows exactly what he's doing. He's a scumbag, though. He hits women. That's the difference between the two.
Yeah.
So if someone's going to get physical, it's probably going to be on Floyd's side, but I don't see Floyd being stupid enough. And don't forget, if for whatever reason it got physical in the street, that fight lasts about 10 fucking seconds.
Yeah,
in a fight?
I've seen, what are we talking about? I've seen people make that point.
I met Floyd once after the Olympics.
He's the size of this microphone. Same color.
after the Olympics, a mutual friend said, oh, I was going to Vegas. He said, oh, go to Floyd's gym, you introduce you to him. And all that. So I went to the gym and I was waiting for him to come in, and there was about 30 people in the gym, and he came in, he walked around and he shook everyone's hand in the gym, come all the way around, and he come to me, and I'm like 28 at the time. He looked me up and down, he went, who the fuck's this white boy? And I was like, whoa.
Which gym was this?
This was his gym in Vegas.
Gym?
And I was like, oh, I'm Tony. And so I went, oh, he's Tony's Olympic medalist from the last Olympics. And I was just thinking, you disrespectful little prick.
Fucking wanker.
But behind him, we had
how
these
scared
big
were
fools.
You?
I mean, I was intimidated because, you know, I was in this gym and
his environment, it's unknown.
And I'm the only white boy
he
there.
He said, who's the fuck's this
Who
white boy?
Who the fuck's this white boy? And I was like, ooh.
Fuck, man.
If that was the other way around, I said, who the fuck's this black man? That's racist.
Yeah, super racist.
Oh, you'd be fucking turfed out in a second.
Yeah.
So since then, I've been...
Black Panther part in, yeah.
I've been fucking... I've hated Floyd since then, you know?
Makes sense. Like, those personal reactions, interactions with people, like... Who the fuck's this white boy? Fuck, man.
I know.
I'm clearly way bigger, so I'm not a threat. I'm not here to scout, you know, what the fuck you're doing.
Yeah.
Man. Then he's surrounded by giant bodyguards.
Yeah. It was fucking crazy. It's like, never meet your heroes. And I mean, he wasn't your hero, but.
Shouldn't be a hero, anyways, but yeah.
But you know what I mean? It's like, shit, that just killed my life.
It just created a whole stir over in England, didn't it? When he went over with Gervonta Davis, just tearing the place up at the hotel press conferences and shit, just disrespectful as fuck to everybody.
Really?
Yeah, just winding up. But I like what you were saying about Conor. He knows what he's doing. It's all
to the fullest.
It's all.
You know what I think as well with Mayweather.
Strategic.
I mean, you're good because you kind of retired from fighting, but you got even more popular with doing the podcast and all that. But with someone like me, I was popular in boxing. All my fights were live on TV, and then I retired. I used to do a tweet and I would get like 150 replies. And then I retired, and then I'd get like 10 replies. And then as time goes on, you get less and less popular. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And on a miles bigger scale, that's happened with Floyd.
Yeah, so
that fucker's getting bored, you know? And he's seen that the biggest superstar in the world, sportsman, is Conor McGregor. And now he's like, I need some of this. That's why he started calling them
out. You're right. You're 100% right.
It
makes
ego.
Him relevant. It's ego, but also Conor kind of has that. Because they both start from the bottom. Now they're here. They have this rough, you know, poor upbringing. And then Conor, you know, is in these chinchilla suits and big
chin.
And he's kind of our version of Floyd without the, you know, the scumbag appeal to
him.
So I think Conor or Floyd sees that like, oh, fuck this, man.
Yeah.
And plus there's opportunity for money there. Like I saw in, again, I'm not picking on Luke Thomas. He's literally one of my favorite people. I love Luke Thomas. And I had to say something on Twitter, but I saw him say, listen, as much as MMA media does want to admit, Floyd Mayweather is the A side here. I disagree. Name someone Floyd could fight that would get this magnitude of pay-per-view. Go name one fucking guy, Glenn.
Huff?
You know boxing. Name one
you
guy.
You can. There isn't
name any. Fucking one.
Nah.
Canelo rematch? Nope. No. Not even close.
There's no one.
Who? Manny Pacquiao again? We're not paying for that bullshit again. Yeah. That fight was terrible. Now you're both old as shit. I'm not watching that. Yeah. Who else? You didn't go up and wait and fight Triple G? Even that wouldn't sell as well.
A guy who can't even speak English, really. It's
but,
not,
the, but the thing is, like...
So Conor, to my point is, he goes, well, who could... maybe he did or some fan did, goes, well, who could Conor fight that would get this amount of payday? That's fine. So I think it's fair to say that they're both A-sides here. One's the A-side of boxing, pay-per-view king of boxing.
Yeah.
One's the A-side of mixed martial arts, pay-per-view king of martial arts.
Which is bigger. The MMA one's bigger
Right now. But also, just go off social media interaction. Look at when Conor tweeted out the fight was announced. Keep fucking crazy numbers. When Floyd did, everyone's like, all right, cool.
That's what I mean. When you retire, you haven't got that limelight again, and you get bored and you get sick of it. And it gets you down a little bit. I was going to ask you about you, if you ever felt down after you retired from boxing.
Yeah, no, killing it. Yeah, no.
But now, I mean, you're doing way better now than you were when you were playing.
No, I hear you, though. When you're done,
when you're done, it's like, shit.
I know.
No one cares.
No one cares.
And even though people still care about Floyd at a massive level, it's not half when he was fighting. So it's when he's put that little tester out about fighting.
And got so much reaction.
He's like, fuck.
I know.
This is going to be a big money fight.
Yep.
I'm in the public eye. I'm the biggest fighter ever.
Plus,
he's smart.
It's going to be an easy fight. He's such a big draw. I'm a big draw. We can do this. I can get to 50. I can beat the record of 49 because he's tied right now with Rocky Marciano. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
So he can beat the 49. NL record. I also think too, you know, like you were saying with fighting, like imagine it's the same feeling. I'm sure. Imagine if you're the hot chick. You've been the hot chick your entire life. It's happened with women in Hollywood. You're the hottest chick in the world, and then next thing you know, you're 40, and dudes aren't looking at you.
Yeah. It's the same at school. I mean, a low level. You got that one hot chick in school who everyone likes, and then they get older and they stay single, and then. Now you're fucking 40 years old, 30 years old.
Then you see her at the supermarket and sweats and a gut. You're like, God,
She could have made something of herself.
I saw something Sergio Martinez put out the other day on Instagram. I don't know if you saw it. He said...
I love him.
When he beat Chavez Jr., he came back to his phone after the fight and all that, and he had over 1,000 missed calls after that fight.
Fuck.
When he fought Miguel Cotto in New York, MSG, it was his last fight, and he was shot and he got knocked out.
That was the worst.
He came back to his phone and there was 4 missed calls. 3 of them were from his mother.
Oh, man.
That's there the bit. So talking about a fall from grace and no one giving a shit when you're done, it was just a perfect example.
And a guy like Floyd with his ego and everything like that.
Yeah, big ego. Yeah, I mean, for me, it was one of the hardest things about coming out of the limelight.
Cause, well, you're used to all that stimulus.
Yeah, you're used to it. And then when it's gone, it's like, fuck, no one gives a fuck about me.
Straight depression.
That's the fight world, though. It's brutal.
That's fight world. Nothing more brutal because you don't have options usually afterwards. But what else is interesting is, to me, like, so this fight goes down. Let's say it goes down how we think. Conor losing a decision, but he doesn't look bad. I think he losing a decision, but they're like, fuck, man, that's not a bad showing for a guy that doesn't box. You know what I'm saying? Loses, gets $100 million. Does he go back and fight in the UFC?
No.
Dana says he does. I go, I disagree.
Really?
And people go, Shab, you say that because you've always said you're not a fighter. No disrespect, but you wouldn't know what it's like to be a fighter. I'm like, I get that. But then if we go back, I'm sure you can find it.
Wait. People say you're not a fighter. What do you mean?
Well, I said that like I'm not a natural born fighter. Like I don't live to fight. Yeah. So, you know, and they're like, Conor does. I'm like, I beg to differ. Because if you go back to his tweets a long time ago, he put, get in, make money, get out.
Yeah, I remember that.
Dot, dot, dot.
Yeah.
Like, that's his whole thing.
Right.
Like, his whole thing is get as much money as possible. His friend suffered from brain trauma. So he's like, get as much money as possible, get the fuck out. I just don't see why, if he makes $100 million off this fight, and I get his star's going to be bigger than ever, then you go back to the UFC and you fight a killer like Khabib Nurmagomedov. Mm-hmm. You fight a guy like Tony Ferguson.
Yeah. Do you think he wins those two fights or not?
I guess you could fight Nate Diaz in a trilogy for the belt.
And get what?
You're not going to beat the same pay-per-view. The thing is, he's going to get crazy pay-per-view numbers. He's going to get so much, you know, shine off that Floyd Mayweather fight. So maybe still makes, let's say he makes the most of any fighter ever in the UFC, makes $30 million for that fight. You just got $100
million.
Yeah.
It's tough to argue. It's
the incentives
it's actually
down
be a tougher fight.
Too,
yeah, it doesn't make sense to me. Yeah. I know Dana goes, no, he promised he's going to fight. Yeah, wait till he gets that $100+ million check.
So on the other side of that, if he performs terrible, and he looks like shit, which is a good possibility fighting Floyd Mayweather.
See, he gets knocked out early.
And gets
stopped.
Oh,
he gets stopped early.
If he gets stopped.
Well, no, he can look bad 100 ways if he's holding on and he's getting hit and he's holding on.
If the MMA world, we win if it goes the distance no matter what.
Yeah, I agree.
We win. Conor wins.
Right.
But if he gets, like, say, in two rounds, he gets smoked.
No, but if he looks terrible
and gets like knocked down every other round,
yeah, and he's getting tired,
back up, I agree.
Then the MMA world doesn't win because it's like, look, you got outclassed. True. But let's say that does happen, which I think it's very possible, and I love Conor.
No.
Where does Conor go from there? Then does he fight in the UFC?
Probably.
Again.
But he's still
got 100 million.
He still gets 100 million.
Either way, he's got nothing to lose. There's no pressure on him. Yeah. Really. There's no pressure.
All the pressure
on Mayweather, definitely.
49-0, yep. Breaking the record,
yep.
King of boxing.
Your entire career on the line.
Not to mention,
it's in
your world. It's in your goddamn pool. And where are you doing the backstroke?
Right. And fair play to him for that, because he's taking something completely unknown and putting his entire career on the line. Fair enough, he's getting ridiculous money, but he's putting a lot on the line with this. It takes a lot of balls to take
this
fight.
But to Floyd, like me, I'm a true boxer, and you've seen what all true boxers think. He's going to fucking outclass him.
Yeah,
so that's what Floyd thinks. What? I'm going to get $100 million to outclass this fucking
guy?
Wrestler.
No fight? Oh, yeah.
And you know what we said on the way in?
Is he mean for a surprise, man?
We were talking earlier about this, and he said the only chance that he kind of has is if Floyd takes him lightly a little bit. And I'm like, he won't. He's such a professional.
It's too much on the line.
That's why he's 49-0.
Yeah, I agree.
Every fight is train his fucking ass off. He never switches off at any point in any fight. There's no showboating. He's 100% professional at all times.
But I don't think of that. I think Floyd's going to come in prime shape.
Oh, yeah.
He's going to take him serious.
Yep.
Like I said, the X factor is something he hasn't seen.
Yep.
And how long it's going to take for his brain at 40, fragile as fuck, to download the data of Conor McGregor before he takes over.
You said Floyd's going to come in prime shape, which I think he will. So you think a prime shape Floyd Mayweather?
Prime 40-year-old Mayweather.
Well, prime shape 40-year-old Floyd Mayweather against a prime shape MMA fighter, Conor McGregor. You think Conor's going to win a round against Mayweather?
Conor, who's, what's Conor, 27, 26?
28.
28 years old, who's in the prime of his career. A prime of his career.
Of his
never
career.
Been in better shape. He's in the, no head trauma. He's fucking ready to go. He has no injuries. He's literally, right now, he's the very best mixed martial artist in the world against a counterpuncher, Floyd, at 40, he's going to be in phenomenal
mixed
shape.
Mixed martial
at
artist.
At 40. I know how I feel at 34 compared to when I was 27, 28.
Right. We'll see. But, I mean, either way, it's so exciting. And I wish people would stop fucking hating.
Oh, me too.
It's so much hating.
This is the thing, T. People are going to hate on it, but all you filthy bitches are going to buy it. Take two baths.
Yeah.
All these fucking whores are going to buy it.
And if they don't buy it, they're going to be clamoring around the laptop. On the Olympic
100%. Stream. I have friends now, like, oh, come Cheeto on, man. Fingers. We're not going to buy it. Like, then you're going to go to friends' house. You'll be at my house. Yeah. Like, can't wait for the spectacle of the year.
Yeah.
And how about Callum's going to stand up on the day? I'm like, do you hate ticket sales?
Did he say he's not going to watch it?
No, he was like, oh, I think I have stand up. I'm like, look at me right now.
Yeah.
Do you think your audience and go, God, should we watch Callum do stand-up for the 100th time, the same set? Or are we going to watch the goddamn athletic event of the century?
Which it really
What are you going to do?
No one's going to have fucking sets. One person in the front row.
No one. No fucking one. Get in, get rich, get out. And that was August 2014.
Wow.
So that's where that comes from. Everyone goes, Schaub, he's a real fighter, not like you. No, you fucking morons. I'm going based off what he says and with my personal conversation with him when I went, this is what you need to do. And he goes, trust me, I have a plan, and broke it down for me. I went, well, there you go. You're fucking brilliant. Yeah. Good luck.
And that's the difference between a smart businessman and a fucking boxer or a fighter.
Yeah.
Right?
Dude, you know how big his entertainment career is going to be after this?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, man,
he can do anything.
He's going to be an Irish Rock. He's going to be fucking in everything. He's going to be Fast and Furious 19, 20, 21, 22. Jump on all over to fucking Die Hard 9, whatever. Yeah. He's going to be in everything.
Yeah. Mate, he posted a video of him in Box and Burn punching one of them round tear bags. And
the water bags?
No, it's like a water bag, but it's a leather lawn stick.
Oh, I love that one.
Yeah. And he posted that. Mate, the Instagram, so you tagged Instagram, Box and Burn on Instagram. The Instagram blew up. Where can I find one of them bags? I want to buy one of them bags. Where do we get?
Different animals.
People's calling the gym. That bag Conor McGregor was hitting. Where do I get? And it's just, you can get them online. So I just chose, like, whatever he puts, he never even put up there, but whatever he puts out there, he can sell it.
I'll tell you right now, we're trying to do a Big Brown Breakdown live in Dublin, too.
Oh, nice. Out
and Manchester. Nice. They're lining up all these dates because I'm going to be slaying some dick jokes. I'm going to be breaking down this fight. They're lining up all these dates.
The thing is now with... with your following, you can do it anywhere. People from Sunderland, where I'm from, are telling me, get Brendan over here, get over here. Get to England, you need to get to England.
I know.
Yeah, keep.
It's just those Manchester bombings kind of scare me, let's be real.
So, what about Klitschko in the gym last week?
Klitschko just strolled
in? Just strolled in.
Mate, I was standing talking to, was it Glenn?
Yeah, we were stood outside the gym.
And then one of the clients comes, I've got someone you might know. Fucking Klitschko, come on. Like, shit.
There was like four huge Russian-looking dudes walking towards the gym. And I'm like this. I'm like, who are these guys? And then as you're getting closer, I'm like, that looks a bit like Klitschko.
You would know right away.
I'm like, Tony, it looks like Klitschko. And then he's like getting closer. I'm like, that's fucking Klitschko.
Shit.
Was he cool?
He never said much until I've got my Olympic medal on the wall or a replica. And he's saying that. He went, oh, you were in the Olympics? And he went, oh, congratulations. Shook me hand. And there's a picture there, O'Connor. Yeah, that's the video there where he's down one, a long left. Yeah. Look at that. I got 41,000 views.
This one right
here? Yeah. I think that's the one that you posted.
That's in the Brentwood gym.
Yeah. That's him just warming up.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, Klitschko coming up was amazing. So I think we'll see him hitting the bag in a sec. It's a slow warm-up, isn't it?
Yeah. Is that slow motion?
Yeah, that bag there behind him. You hit that one all the time, Brennan.
Oh, yeah, I love that bag. Teared up. Yeah.
But he posted a longer video on his website about...
That's
about
cool, man.
It was awesome, mate. The phone
is Klitschko going to be coming in the gym or what?
Yeah, that bag there.
I'm trying to sniff around.
Yeah,
They went right back to Germany like the next day, I think.
Because his missus on
Hayden Panettiere, I know.
Yeah, she lives in LA, so he said he spent half his time out here, half time there, looking for a gym to train at. So, and obviously we've got the fucking fantastic gym, the best one around, so he's going to come train ours.
Sick,
so that'd be awesome. And
I want to get my whistle wet, just kind of move around. This Connor kind of drama.
Yeah, and call him out.
Call him out. He's like, who? I'm like, nah, you know you want it. You know you want it, bro. Be unpredictable. But you fight just like a traditional boxer who wrestles. Ah, whatever.
Is that fight confirmed yet with Joshua and
Yeah,
people?
Yeah.
It is?
Is it November?
Because they have to do it in a certain amount of time, otherwise they have to vacate the belt.
Yeah,
so it's happening.
I think they're still working on the venue.
I'm excited about that.
Yeah,
I'm
excited. It's going to be great. That was a great fight.
Let's move on. Obviously, the Conor thing. That's why I wanted you guys here, because you have personal experience with Conor. He's been in the gym, and then you guys know boxing better than anyone I know. So that's why I wanted you guys here.
Nice.
But the other thing is tomorrow night, it's Friday afternoon right now in LA, hot as shit. But tomorrow night, and I post about this, I'm like, and this fight's getting no love, and it's a phenomenal fight. You got Kovalev versus Andre Ward, too. I think Andre Ward's ranked number 2 pound for pound in the world, and Kovalev's number 5. Not a single person. Not one person I know is like, because I was like, yo, man, I'm having the fight. What? There's a fight tomorrow? I'm like, are you kidding me?
So, you know, when people say the McGregor-Mayweather thing's great for boxing because it gets people talking about boxing, but you just proved it. No one's talking about this fight. And
it's just bad timing.
It's just bad timing. It's
bad timing.
Totally, yeah.
It's bad timing.
I think after when this is all said and done, boxing will
be
on the up.
It's bad timing for Kovalev Ward, because if they would have been next week or the week after, they wouldn't be so fucked. It's just you're the same week of this announcement.
Yeah. But even it's not that big, because neither fight is very marketable.
Neither one's a draw either.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, no one really, and I don't understand, and Andre Ward in an interview even talks about this, he just doesn't get love from the American fans for some reason.
Yeah, it's weird.
I don't know if because he's
I think he's
so
my
religious
favorite fighter.
Or what. He's your favorite fighter?
Just on a skill level, and I love the way he conducts himself out of the ring. He's professional, he's respectful, he's just a smart guy, and that's probably the reason he's not that marketable, because he doesn't say controversial shit. He doesn't talk trash. He just gets in there and gets on with it. And he's not lost a fight since he was 12. And he can fight any way, any style of fight, inside, outside. He's a great fighter.
I hear all that religious shit. Like, thank God.
Yeah, but
this,
I'm not bothered about that. I can. That's
and
his
then, and then as for he's not lost a fight, he lost the last fight. He never got the decision, but he lost the last fight.
Nah, he
did. So,
I've watched that fight five times.
Me too.
Five times?
I've watched it three. three.
So when I watched it live, and I was like,
I watched it last
definitely
night.
Kovalev. I watched it live, Kovalev. And then I watched it the next day, and I tried to be like really objective with it, and I had Ward by one, and then I watched it a couple of times since.
I would love to watch it with you, but I'm not going to, because that'll be the sixth time you watched it.
What I think happened in the first fight, just to sum up real quick, I feel like all the stuff that went on inside, from round five on, I thought, maybe the 10th round Kovalev won, but round five on, I think Ward won every round.
Bullied him?
Out-bullied the shit out of him. As soon as they got in the clinch, Kovalev did not want to know, and he was just smashing. He was so aggressive.
Thing.
He out-bullied him and took took the fight out of him. And his legs and his snap and his sharpness was gone from round five.
From round five Kovalev, on, Kovalev died.
Kovalev's blaming that on his training camp and not being prepared and not training properly. But I blame it on Ward out-bullying him and smashing and the shit shots. Out of his body and his hips and everything.
I think it's a combination of
both. You don't die
both.
In a fight in round five and six if you're conditioned
stuff.
For a world title fight.
I think it's a combination of both. I think Kovalev's cardio, which should be better this fucking fight. Mm-hmm. If Kovalev can go 12 rounds, he beats Andre Ward. If his cardio is better that last round, he easily beats him last fight.
Well, the reason why he got so tired was he put him down in the second round and he went fucking hell for leather. He thought, I'm going to knock this fucker out. And then he went, give it everything, and then he got tired.
He also chased Andre Ward. Like early on, but before round five, he was cutting the ring off. He wasn't chasing him so much. And then after he knocks him down and he's getting tired, he was chasing. He got away from his jab, who I think he has the best jab in the world.
Yeah.
Maybe
yeah.
him or Klitschko. But he got away from his jab. He stopped doing.
Credit to Ward for all those. That's the
you think? Give, or is it a matter of
he Kovalev adjusted
just
to that
tiring out?
No, I think he adjusted to the knockdown so well. If you watch, like, I think a few minute or two after the knockdown, he had him pinned up on the ropes and he was in trouble for a little bit. And then after that round, after he came back from the corner after the knockdown round, so round three on, he just adjusted so well.
I think Kovalev wins this in another close decision. I think Kovalev wins and then they do the
trilogy.
Yep.
After the fifth round, you're talking about them rounds were so close.
Yeah, I'm not saying they're not close.
And I've never done this before in my life, but I knew I was coming to this podcast and I wanted to be prepared. So I went and I scored each round and I was trying to be generous to Ward and I still give it to Kovalev by two rounds.
Really? Me too, man.
Because it was like the close rounds were like this, but I would just give it to Kovalev.
He was a bit aggressor, he landed more here.
And I like to get your opinion on this. And I hate when people say to beat the champion, you've got to go in there and fucking take it off him.
Yeah. I disagree with that. Yeah.
Why can't you just have win a the fair fight?
Yeah. But also in that fight, Kovalev's the champion.
Oh, that's right.
Kovalev's the champion. Yeah. You have to take his belt.
But that's what they said about the next fight. Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? In that fight, Kovalev was the champ.
So now twist that around to the second fight. So Kovalev's got to go above and beyond now that Ward's the champion, right?
If not going really. By that logic. Same judges. To them, it's whatever.
Right, yeah.
I think Kovalev wins. I think he uses his distance. I think he uses his jab. I'm assuming his cardio is going to be better, and he wins probably seven rounds.
The only thing, they've both got to adjust, obviously, right? I just think that based on skill set, Andre Ward's way more capable of just adjusting and changing things and doing things differently than Kovalev is. I think Kovalev, as amazing as he is, his style is pretty one-dimensional. He's pretty straight and relies on shots a lot.
Kovalev killed a guy. Kinda,
yeah, he did, yeah.
Killed a guy in the
killed
ring.
Killed a guy, yeah.
And said now he fights to honor that guy that died by his hands.
Right.
Some cold Russian shit.
Yeah.
You can't see he's one-dimensional because he can do everything. He's can box so on his front foot, his back foot, lateral movement, head, body, mix it all up, put combinations together, throw single shots. His boxing skills are phenomenal.
I just don't think he's as varied as Ward is.
But Ward is
versatile.
Yeah, I think he's really got Ward's number, and I agree with you on this, B, that I think he's going to win on points as well. Yep. I think Henri Ward's going to really dig deep and change his game plan, but I really think he's got his number. And he's.
I just see Ward being a lot more aggressive in this fight.
He's going to get knocked out then.
Yeah.
See? The biggest thing Kovalev's going to be in shape. What I thought was interesting about Kovalev too is I was doing some research on him and watching the Countdown show is he sat down with what's homeboy's name? Not Max Kellerman. Is it Dan Lampley?
Oh, Jim Lampley.
Jim Lampley. Yeah. Sat down with Jim Lampley and Jim was like, you know, in your corner, you have the black guy, what's his name? Who?
Virgil Hunter. David John Jackson.
David John Jackson. Yeah, yeah. If you have David John Jackson, he's not talking. You have this Russian guy.
Yeah, yeah.
And he goes, yeah, that's my boy. He looks at the fight from a different angle. He's all I want to talk to. And he goes, I organize all my own. I do all my own camp. He just holds mitts.
Yeah.
He doesn't come up with the game plan. He goes, I do all the game plan. Then I hire this new strength conditioning coach straight from Russia. This guy could not get more Russian.
Right.
And they show him doing all this new stuff so he doesn't get overtrained. He said he was running, especially at light heavyweight, 14 miles a day.
Yeah. Wow. For the last fight.
You didn't need to.
Yeah.
For the last fight, he was running marathon distance.
That's what they said.
Like,
they
said, no wonder you had no fucking.
Yeah, they were like, you didn't need to do that. But he was just like, no, I want to be in the best shape ever. And it fucking went backwards because he came.
It was so controversial that his trainer went to Ward's camp.
David John Jackson tried to get into Andre Ward's camp.
He was asking if he'd come in. So they entertained the idea to see how far he would go. And then And then they were like, nah, fuck that. We don't want you on here.
See, I don't know if that's true. They asked Kovalev, and he was like, that's not true. That's them starting that rumor.
Yeah, there's two totally different accounts.
Because Kovalev's like, that's not true. I've been with him since I've been in the States. Why would he go over there? We won that fight.
Right.
And then he goes, also, they're trying to start things here. And he goes, I come up with my own game plans. Like, he just holds the mitts. I've always come up with my
own
game
plans. And that's the reason why he would want to go, because he's just a joy.
He's sick of being a monkey.
Yeah, exactly.
So I saw an interview with David John Jackson after the last fight,
and he was sick of being a puppet.
Yeah, he was pissed off about that Russian guy. He's like, I'm in the corner training instructions, and I couldn't do shit. There was just some Russian guy telling him everything. That's what he said.
Does that Russian guy have a boxing knowledge? Or
I don't
what's
even
going
know
on
he is.
Here?
Yeah,
like he was just there.
David John Jackson said he is this Russian guy who knows fuck all about boxing. That's what
he's
he said.
He's just his boy.
Yeah, he's just some guy.
Well, wasn't that kind of the same with Manny Pacquiao when he had Freddie Roach? There was some guy.
The fat guy.
Yeah.
What's his name?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
He used to wear the body shield,
like
get punched
Spoon or something. I forget what his name is. Something like that.
And then I remember when Chavez Jr. was fighting when Freddie Roach trained him, and Alex Ariza was giving the instructions.
That's right.
Because he could speak Spanish.
That's right.
Alex Ariza knows fuck all about boxing.
Nothing.
And Freddie Roach told Alex Ariza, he's like, tell him in Spanish, this. And he didn't say anything. He just kept his mouth shut. I was like, what the
so
fuck?
So weird.
Talking about that first fight, did you see Ward's face when they announced the decision?
Yes. He was so surprised.
Hey. Yeah.
He was so surprised.
Yeah, I think he thought he hadn't got it.
Oh, 100%.
When I watch Andre Ward in these countdowns and I watch his interviews, he's a little punchy, man. He's had a lot
Ward?
Of, like, he's a little bit like...
Really?
I think he just looks like that. Because his speech is all right now, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a little slow.
It is?
Maybe I'm being...
But he's got that look where his eyes were.
He's a little bit like a little out to dinner.
Like Glenn said, he's not lost a fight since he was 12. So
a lot of fighting, though.
Yeah? He knows how to adjust.
A lot of fighting, no matter what. Even if you're winning, you're fighting.
Oh, yeah, 100%. And the sparring and all that. But what I'm thinking was maybe for that fight with Kovalev... He took his foot off the gas in training. Imagine if you've never been beat before. Because you're like, fuck.
But Kovalev, it's his first time at light heavyweight. He has one fight at light heavyweight. It goes all right. He outclassed the guy. But then the only reason he came there is to fight a guy like Kovalev. That's like his very first big test.
Yeah.
Like, he hasn't had that many big tests. A Kovalev is a fucking
I'll tell you
monster.
What, you've got to take your hat off him for taking that fight. For stepping up before.
Crazy.
Paul Smith. Then he had two middleweight. Then he fought. Two light heavyweights. And
his whole thing has always been, the knock against him, he doesn't fight often enough. So like,
he's in that contract dispute with the Goose and promotions forever. And then he finally got out of it. You know, he's active again. I wish he'd get more recognition. I just think he's the guy.
Well, they
still
rank him number two, pound for pound.
Yeah.
But Lomachenko number one, Gennady number three.
Right.
You've got to be marketable.
Crawford number four.
To get more recognition, you've got to be marketable.
Outside. This day and age?
Outside.
Well,
on
compete with Conor. You compete with Conor. With Mayweather. Fucking Broner. Like, there's a lot of fucking guys that...
Yeah.
Like, Broner's not nowhere near as good as these guys.
Yeah.
I know more people know Broner than these two.
Yeah, but I bet he's made more money, you think?
Andre Ward?
Broner than Andre Ward.
No, I think Andre Ward's made more money than Broner.
I don't know, I don't know.
I don't know.
He's getting big fights.
He's been fighting at a higher level for a lot longer than Broner.
He's been world champion way longer.
Broner's marketable, even though he's a little fucker.
He's crazy.
Net worth, he's only 3 million. Even though his nickname's AB about billions, he's got 3 million.
That's tough.
It's seven figure.
Oh, 8 million.
8 million, yeah.
How is Andre Ward only worth $8 million?
I mean, it's a lot in boxing.
It's probably more now.
Can you put Ricky Hatton in there?
Ricky Hatton has $7 now. And he weighs 300 pounds. Ricky Hatton, can you buy him a beer?
40 million.
Do you know what I was thinking the other week?
Jesus Christ.
You
got paid off Mayweather.
Yeah.
I was thinking the other day, like, I don't know any other fighter in the world who retired from fighting and went into comedy and done successful as fuck, apart from you. I think the only
another athlete,
I think the only other person who could have done it would have been Ricky Hatton.
Really?
Yeah, because he does them
talks,
public
and them
speaking.
Stand-up.
Oh, he does.
Hilarious,
is he?
Yeah,
he's hilarious.
He just tells stories.
40 million.
Damn, he's killing it. The English have some.
Cole French's money has mostly come from property, though. I think he's big in like real estate and stuff in England.
But
Americans filthy rich.
With Ricky Hatton, because he was one of the biggest ticket sellers of all time.
He was huge,
right?
Yeah.
He was huge.
Yeah.
Oh, would it be interesting to see what his ticket sales were like compared to Conor's? You know,
that is interesting.
Ricky Hatton would sell.
You know what?
He's huge now, meaning like weight wise, right? Like he blew the fuck up.
Oh yeah, yeah. After every fight, he got
thyroid
massive
issues.
But did you see that story when he was? sniffing cocaine in a hotel room. It was on the front page of the newspaper, and I heard that he was in a hotel with his missus somewhere in England, and he went and got the newspaper from outside the door in the morning, went into bed and fucking sat, put his feet up. Boom, front page, Ricky just snorting coke with some.
Do you get a picture of him snorting?
Yeah.
With a random whore.
Yeah, this woman, she...
Oh, no.
When I saw the picture, I felt sick. I was just like...
Every guy's like, ah.
Everyone loves Ricky.
Every girl's like, what a
big fat Rolex right on the counter, and just like, it was just like.
She set her phone up and fucking videoed. He's off his face just sniffing coke. Yeah, it was like, poor Ricky.
What a bitch.
Yeah. He got over it well. He hired the best, the entertainment publicist in the world. And I'm depressed after fighting, getting knocked out of Floyd and Manny Pacquiao. I apologize. Look there.
I was just trying to party.
That's it.
Oh,
he's got the role. He's like, well, the watch he's on.
Fuck.
Yeah, and it's like,
he has a couple lines there, and he is thicker than a Snickers snorting that cocaine.
That was the full pitch.
So Mickey Coke, shame.
Imagine you don't know about it, and you see the actual paper.
You're in bed with your missus, and you're fucking open the newspaper, and that's
thank God not some whores behind him in like a thong or something.
Well, not the video. She's talking. I'm sure she's talking or some shit, and she's like. But then
come on, Ricky.
Then she said, I was his friend. I'd done this for his own good or whatever.
Like, she almost set him up to try and get him.
Bullshit.
Like,
yeah. There's other ways you could do it. God, he is thicky. I don't blame him, though.
Yeah, but he is one funny bastard. One great, great person.
Is he? Good funny storyteller?
Yeah. He used to do the after dinner speaking. I mean, it's similar to what you do.
Yeah, it's performing. He's telling stories and
stuff. He gets on the top table and he tells his stories, tells his story, and people's laughing their heads off. And then he takes pictures with him after and charges.
I wasn't going to bring this up, but just to shit on Ricky Hatton, his storytelling, is, you know, I'm doing This Is Not Happening. I just got confirmation I'm doing on Comedy Central, the actual TV show, where I go up there. They have like six comedians.
Oh, shit.
Actually tell a story on Comedy Central.
That's amazing.
I film it Tuesday night.
Nice.
That's amazing.
When's that going to be out?
I'm not sure. I'm sure shortly after.
Shit.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
I mean,
just found out.
Your biggest talent is storytelling.
Yeah.
You fucking agree on it?
That's what you kind of say as well. It's like, I don't really tell jokes. Just go up and just talk and just talk shit. You're like a naturally funny person. So that's why it works.
Yep.
You're very controversial as well. Like every time you come to the gym, we always going back and forth.
Always.
You love the
offer.
Do you want to tell Tony the first part of the Australian gig was?
Oh, with the koala and stuff?
You're on the Asians.
Oh, Chin heard all this. I talked about this before. I was so surprised how many Asians were in Australia. You've been to Australia?
Yeah, right? I love Australia.
Which, you've been to Sydney?
Melbourne.
Melbourne, not as much, right?
I think everywhere there's
in,
a lot.
In Sydney, it was, Chin came out, and I love me an Asian. I mean, I got Korean working here. Right? He's the best part of the show. I love me an Asian. I love Asian food. Shout out PF Chang's. I love all that shit. But it was, Sydney might as well be little Tokyo. I mean, I was like, where in the fuck are all the white people?
Australia?
No kangaroos, no koalas, all Asians, all like little Asian dino, everywhere, right, Chin?
Everywhere. And big rats.
The big fattest rats you've ever seen.
Yeah, huge rats.
Shit.
Come on, mate. Fucking pipe that down a little bit.
Like possums then, right?
Like that.
Possum.
Real.
They're called possums.
Really?
Yeah, basically, a possum's a possum. It looked like a possum.
Wow, yeah, but they're rats?
They don't ever call Brad a possum though, huh? In England, do you guys have possums?
No. Not really, no, do we?
No, I thought, but I was surprised we got off the thing. I was like, oh, is it like National Asian Day? And they're like, no, this is life, son.
That's fucking mad.
Because Asia's close. I was asking them.
China.
Not that I give a fuck. I love Asian people. But I've never been there. And when you think of Australia, you think outback, white as fuck. Like only white people. Koalas hanging from trees. High-fiving kangaroos. Another shrimp on the barbie.
Yeah.
Outback steakhouses doing all that shit.
Yeah.
You know, and rugby and Australian football and all that. No, I was like, hiya. Like, it was like.
Well, when I went to Melbourne, it was in 2006. I fought in the Commonwealth Games. Have you heard of them before?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's a big, massive tournament.
Huge.
And it was great. And it was like what you were thinking, like Aborigines sitting on the fucking street blowing trumpets and all that.
What the fuck? When we're in Melbourne, none of that now.
So it must have changed. It must have got overpopulated.
They were just saying that because Asia's right there. So they go, that's where
Singapore, I think.
Singapore, they all go there.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've heard San Francisco's starting to turn like that as well because all the Chinese are coming in and buying all the property, like all of the property for ridiculous money.
Yeah.
Just to get the green cards and all that.
California in general, like, I mean, there's a lot. Not that there's an issue with it, but
same kind of thing with America. All the English people just think you come out here and you just eat double cheeseburgers and huge, massive things of Coke, and everyone's fat.
They'd be correct.
We were in,
for the most part.
Yeah, we were in Orlando. We were in Orlando doing the Boxman Academy a couple of weeks ago, and English people normally go to Orlando, Florida, if they come to America for a holiday.
For just holiday.
Yeah, right? And I can see why they see that everyone in America is obese.
That's not real, yeah. It's not. Because you go to Disneyland here, you're like, God damn, why is everyone so out of shape? They're just downing Coca-Cola, you know, funnel cakes and all this shit. Yeah. Just for whatever reason, those amusement parks just bring out the fattest people in the world.
Yeah.
And that's
happiest place on earth, my ass.
And that's the image that English people have got of America because of that. That's where they come. But then you come to LA, you kind of find a fat person, like west side of LA.
No,
where
it's so health conscious here. Or you go to Austin.
Right.
Like everything's health conscious, man. Yeah. Organic food. No one fucks with chains. You better be doing running. You better be outside on the beach. You better be doing rock climbing, hiking, you know, canyon, all that stuff.
Yeah.
Just different animal.
Yeah. But I couldn't believe it. Like, Every restaurant, we couldn't find organic food anywhere.
No, around there is Olive Garden, Red Lobster, Red Robin.
It's all just chains, is it?
You got current events, Chin, or no?
I got a few things.
Let's just do a few, and then I'll get these cats out of here.
All right, so Dana White says that the fight with McGregor and Mayweather doesn't hurt the UFC, regardless of what happens. It doesn't hurt McGregor or the UFC. But you guys kind of talked about
it. We just talked about that. Yeah. I think it hurts the UFC. Well, I don't know if it hurts the UFC.
If he gets knocked out, it hurts us.
Yeah.
If he gets knocked out, well.
But even if he looks terrible.
Yeah, but does it hurt us? Because everyone in the mainstream, like 90% of the world, which don't have a shit clue of fighting, think Conor's going to go in there and get knocked out. So if he does get knocked out, it's like, oh, yeah, he doesn't do that, man. Back to his sport.
Right.
But maybe to me it would be embarrassing for the sport.
I think he's going to get knocked out. Oh, like I said, God, well, we've just had a $2,000 bet.
$2,000 bet.
We'll see.
But well, if Conor knocks him out, you don't get $2,000.
Oh no! I'll give you the $2,000. Yeah, I'll give you the $2,000.
Still give me, if McGregor wins any fashion, I win.
Yeah.
Or
lose
decision.
Oh, yeah.
If he loses in decision, I win.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
All right, mate.
All right. Absolutely not what he said about the potential McGregor loss impacting him and UFC long term. At the end of the day, these two guys wanted this fight. The fans wanted this fight. I agree. They wanted the fight and the fans. And now everyone's just hating on it.
Why would you not want to see it? That's my big thing. Yeah, why would you not?
Conor's a mixed martial artist. He's going into a boxing match, arguably the greatest boxer of all time. I don't think it damaged the brand or Conor McGregor at all. I agree. I think unless he gets knocked out like the first 30 seconds, it elevates the UFC and like, everyone's brand.
Like that time when, was it James Toney coming and he fought?
Randy Couture?
Yeah.
That was but also that to James Toney defense, and we all knew how he fought a pure grappler, one of the greatest grapplers of all time, Randy Couture, world-class wrestler, and also a phenomenal UFC champion, heavyweight, light heavyweight. And then James Toney comes in, tits.
Yeah.
With tits and love handles.
Like, I think he's the only guy to go from. He's the only guy to go from, like.
I talked to his trainer, and he's like, I might have trained 3 weeks total. Like and then we tried going with wrestling. He's like, I don't need that shit.
Yeah.
But the scary thing about that fight, where one of us, we were kind of tuned in, because if James Toney lands with those 4-ounce gloves on Randy Couture's face, he's in so much fucking trouble.
Yeah.
And that's where you're like, God, fuck. Like, Randy Couture demon. Initiate stand up. He fucking just basically taught it as a straight high school wrestling match and he picked him.
Right.
It was brilliant.
But I think that's
ankle picked him, sorry.
That's what happened with most boxers if they went in with MMA.
Yeah.
Unless you can land like that.
It's just a different game.
Yeah.
Well, like today I read Michael Phelps is going to race a great white shark in the water. I want to see that shit. I will pay cold, hard American cash for that shit.
Yeah.
Now, is that a bit of a circus? Whatever you want to fucking call it. Michael Phelps versus whoever another swimmer is. I don't see that basic
shit. Yeah.
I want to see Michael Phelps race that goddamn great white shark because I've never seen that shit before.
Yeah, entertainment.
Hell yeah, it's entertainment.
I'll pay for that shit. I'll pay for
that. Fuck yeah. What else you got, Chin?
All right, the television broadcast team was announced for the McGregor-Mayweather fight, and here's the list right here.
Oh, Brendan's on it.
It's exclusive to Showtime, right?
Yes.
So Brian Custer, host, Morinalo, play-by-play.
Love him.
Al Bernstein, color analyst. Paul Malignaggi, color analyst.
Paulie Malignaggi. I love Paul, but...
You don't like Malignaggi? He's a commentator.
I like him. He's going to hate on Conor.
Yeah, he will. He's a boxing
Jim player. Gray. Jim Gray's a good guy.
Who's the MMA guy there?
Mauro Ranallo, but...
But they said they will have other MMA people.
My team's reaching out to Showtime now to see if there's some way I can be part of it. My issue is you don't have anyone representing Conor in the way that there is a slight chance Conor can actually bring something to this fight.
Yeah.
Like I can't, like Mauro might do it, but Mauro's balls deep in boxing too, man. Oh, so yeah. that entire list there, no one's educated on mixed martial arts. Mauro is.
Yeah.
But in around those guys, is he going to validate and give us credit? Because I will battle to the fucking death on this.
Yeah, they need you on there. Definitely need you on there to see what you've just been seeing earlier on.
Ugh.
Yeah,
people that's cool, though. I'm working with Mauro on Saturday in New York.
The difference, what you're saying is, it's what you're saying is actually credible.
Oh, yeah.
Anyone who's bigging up Conor to this.
Most of it.
A lot of
just the unknown factor and just talking about details like styles and different angles.
There's only one other guy in media doing this, but he's doing it because the producer's telling me to take this angle, and that's Skip Bayless at Fox. But Skip's never been the only thing Skip's fought in his life is a wet paper that he's reading, you know. So that doesn't represent us, and it's all fake. Like him and Shannon Sharpe argue because the producers say, Shannon, you take this. Skip, you take this, even though you don't know shit about the sport. You argue this. Like, I can't even watch it because it's so scripted and they're told what to say.
Yeah.
But that doesn't count. I'm the only guy who can validate.
Yeah, and you can argue like fuck. So that's why they need you.
Look at that. Is that Boss Logic?
That's Boss Logic.
What? Showtime, whoever. Fucking, that's the poster you need to use. Class, this is a money fight. They're both about money. It's a money match.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Is that, yeah.
So that's Boss Logic and this is Showtime's.
Why red? Official. Why use blood? Why are you doing that? Why are you doing that Showtime? It's at Boss Logic, I think, on Twitter and Instagram. This motherfucker is a beast.
Yeah, that's
look
amazing.
This dude up. He's so good.
Does he do any of your work? Show stuff.
He's never done mine's Average Joe, who's also a fucking monster. Average Joe Art, I think, on Instagram. He's so fucking good. But this guy specializes in just fight posters. Look at that poster.
That's awesome.
I have one coming out for my tour to break down this fight.
Yeah.
And you'll see it. It's sick.
You going on tour again?
Yeah.
Where are you going?
Long Beach, Phoenix, and then they're trying to figure out the rest of these dates. You know, Chicago, Toronto, Salt Lake, Denver, Dublin, Manchester, like a bunch of other.
You must be really enjoying it if you're doing this shit because you don't need to do it.
I love it. I absolutely love it. I love it, but I also like, you know, I love it and I love to get, like, I'll get even at the live shows, and Chin can vouch for this, I'll get even more detailed on this fight and like what I think's gonna happen, break it down to fucking even more. Yeah. So I'll do the way the show breaks down is I do my stand-up for about the first 45 minutes, and then I do current events like we do here. Like you do some improv jokes and stuff with all the current fight events, and then I break down the big fight.
Right.
So I'll break down this.
Do you get questions as well?
Then I do fan questions, and it gets weird.
Yeah, I bet.
It gets really weird.
That's the. I mean, I come and seen you and Brian. Where was it in LA when you were
comedy
there
store,
a while ago?
First time we did Comedy Store.
Right. And I think the fan questions was the best because it does get weird and it gets entertaining, you know?
Because it's unfiltered.
And it puts you on the spot as well, which you fucking love and you thrive off.
I remember one of the questions from that show as well, speaking of Asians.
What was it?
Was it the Mile High Club or whatever it was?
Oh, yeah.
Did Brian Hammer someone?
Brian's fucked an Asian on the plane.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. They get so weird, man.
Yeah.
But also, those fan questions can make or break a show, but that's what you end on. So, like, if they're drunk or it's just stupid sex questions, it's always awkward.
Yeah.
But, like, Sydney was a beast. Melbourne, beast. All these cool questions. The best. Educated questions.
Then after you've done the stand-up, you've done a VIP where you meet everyone.
Yeah, meeting.
How was that?
It was cool. Like, the thing is that, you know, I love doing it, but that, you know, that's probably the most energy draining part of it because you're, you know, and I think I had, 170 VIPs in Sydney. So,
wow.
You know, and you don't, like, I'm not wasting anyone's time. So, like, one person I might spend 10 minutes with because we're talking about Conor Floyd, and I will break it down, and they'll give their points. And I love a debate, so we'll go back and forth. And the next person might come up and be like, I just want a picture. Cool.
Right.
Next person might come up, hey, man, what do you think of this? And it's another fight.
Yeah.
It's fun as fuck, though. Like, my last night in Sydney, I probably spent damn near 2 hours with him.
Yeah. Shit. That's great, though. That's great that you spend all that time with people because they come and travel and they come to see
you. Yeah, for sure.
And spend time.
Yeah. And like you said, like, I mean, if you're going to pay money to sit down, like, I'm not trying to get out of there. I'm not trying to rush. I want everyone to be like, damn, that was dope. That was sick. Because, like, you met Floyd Mayweather. Like, fuck that guy.
Yeah.
Like, I met guys before. And I'm like, oh, fuck that guy. Like, I do not want that.
You don't
want
to be that
what
guy.
What else you got, Chin?
You want to get into what you said earlier about the Max Kellerman bet?
Sure.
Because I found one of these articles.
Oh, nice. Look at that. Fuck, you know.
Brandon Schaub will bet $100,000 that Conor McGregor wins rounds against Floyd Mayweather Jr.
You crazy bastard.
Hey, and look at the picture of Floyd laughing on the ground.
Look at the video of Boxing Burn at the right of him.
What's this say? So, longtime boxer, first time Excalibur is not impressed. That's because he's uneducated. There's a big difference. You're not impressed because you're uneducated.
Did he get back to you after that?
I think his team reached out to my team.
Right.
Not personally on. I haven't been on my Instagram or Twitter today.
See, it says, Kellerman says, I'm a big McGregor fan, but he doesn't know. I get the vibe he knows fuck all about MMA. I mean, I'm first person. I mean, I know fuck all about MMA. I'm a boxing fan. So why can't he just say that first and say, look, I know fuck all about MMA. I only know
but
boxing.
But I know this.
But here's my opinion. Yeah.
I agree.
Right.
Because he put, quote, I'm a big McGregor fan. If he had been boxing this whole time, maybe we have a different story. Let me tell you what's going to happen. Conor McGregor will not land a single punch on Floyd Mayweather. And then doubles down on it, not a single punch.
Not one punch.
Kellerman must have been watching this video, that bullshit sparring video. Not long after that's announced, former UFC heavyweight Brandon Schaub goes, let me tell you something. I guarantee Conor lands not only punch, but wins rounds. Matter of fact, I would be willing to bet $100,000 on it. You game Max Kellerman.
$100,000 on a round or the fight? What?
No, that he doesn't land one punch.
That he doesn't land one punch and he wins a round.
Shit, mate. You're fucking mad. You're fucking mad. Telling you, you're mad.
What's up? I'm going to get that 100 G's.
100 G.
I just want to get that $2,000 off you. I'll be happy with that.
That's hilarious. We'll see, man. Ball's in his court and his team.
Yeah, I hope he comes back. In fact, I don't because I like you. I want you to keep your fucking money.
Oh, you think I'm losing? My brother thinks I'm losing money too. You guys are fucking crazy. Yeah, that's the easiest money I've ever made.
Nah.
Oh, my God.
That, one round? He only has to win one round.
Just one round. Only.
Good luck with that. Yeah, fighting Floyd Mayweather.
Fucking true.
Fucking beast. One of the greatest fighters of all time. Good round. Good luck with fucking winning a round against him.
No, I get the odds are against me. I like my odds. I like my odds. I can't stand this. And Mario Lopez is the same thing too. Is when they discredit the fight and the capabilities of Conor McGregor. Do you realize what that guy has done in mixed martial arts at the very highest level, fighting in three different weight classes? With his skill set is fucking insane.
Yeah, at mixed martial arts.
Yes.
Amazing. At mixed martial arts.
Yeah, mixed martial arts, which is the hardest sport in the world to dominate in those different weight classes. And your margin of error is way less than boxing, especially at 154 pounds.
I'll tell you what, give it this. 147 give it pounds. This. When Conor did come to the gym, he sparred a few times. I was impressed with his boxing. I really was. Like, fuck. If I never knew who he was and I was watching from the outside, I would have thought he was a top professional boxer.
I've heard people say he's had amateur fights, and I've seen media outlets say he's had no amateur fights. Do we know whether he has or not?
I think he's had like smokers. He wasn't like.
Oh really?
I thought he
was an Irish amateur boxer.
Right.
See, I've heard. Yes, people said, "Oh, he's an Irish amateur boxing champion." I haven't heard that.
No, I don't think it was the champ, but I thought he had fights as an amateur.
I'm sure he was younger. Did, but even then,
I mean, everyone has an Ireland.
Yeah, I agree. You know? It's like, but what's this, Jin?
So that's where the opening odds were, right? Floyd Mayweather was minus 1,100.
Yeah, I got it at 650.
Plus 600. Yeah. And now it's changed to Floyd Mayweather is minus 600.
Which are better odds than when he fought Maidana?
really?
Yeah.
I don't get minus 600. We say 2-1 or 3-1.
So for Floyd, if you put down $100, you would get $400 back.
So for Floyd?
For Conor. So if you bet,
so he's
Conor,
4-1 then,
right? 4-1. So he's like minus.
Conor, yeah.
It's like
you'd have to
bet
600 to win 100.
Correct.
I think.
Yeah. Correct.
Yeah.
6-1.
And then here's the big things. Method of victory.
Why didn't you just fucking put your $100,000 on this rather than betting Max Kellerman?
Because
you know what I mean.
No,
you
want to make because I want to shove it down Max's throat. Floyd Mayweather by decision or technical decision plus 130. Conor McGregor by TKO or DQ 550. Conor McGregor, yeah.
Fight drawn, 2,500 to 1. Shit.
Imagine that.
Floyd Mayweather by majority decision plus 2,800.
Fucking hell.
Floyd Mayweather by technical decision plus 800.
Are they actually taking bets now? Is this?
Oh yeah, you can.
Did you?
Yeah, you can bet on this.
Not on the rounds.
Oh, you're picking the fucking hell. Look at that for the rounds. Floyd Mayweather in round one. Look at that. So what's that? That's that chain. 2,500.
It's like 2,500 to 1, right?
So if I bet $100 on that, what would I get?
Damn, I always mess this up.
On which one?
On Mayweather in the first round?
Oh, yeah. You're going to get, you bet $100, you can get $25. Or you get $2.50, I think. To waste your fucking time. But here, check this out. This, and now just hear me out. If Connor's going to knock him out, it's going to be that first one or two rounds. If he is, it's not a bad idea to put $1 on Conor McGregor at plus 4,000. $1 gets you $4,000.
All right, let's go down. Yes. Let's go down strategy route, right? What do you think he's going to do first round? Like, what do you think? What do you see Conor doing? Is he just going to come out super aggressive safe. As fuck? Yeah. Or is he gonna? Is it just going to be like a lot of fucking standing off and kind of waiting for a
couple
of rounds?
Conor, he's going to come out pretty aggressive, but yeah. he's going to have the reach advantage and the speed advantage.
Not speed. Conor's not faster than Floyd Mayweather. You're fucking crazy. Nah. Nah, I think he's going to come out. I think, obviously, Mayweather's going to be...
They're both going to be feeling each other out.
Yeah, feeling each other out for a long
that
time.
That could be a round for Conor.
And then...
He's the aggressor.
Yeah, and then, nah.
Ring generalship.
Because Mayweather's going to hit him.
No.
He's going to hit in the first
not
round.
Not early on.
Mate, I'm telling
you. Floyd's going to be playing it really safe to download his data first because he don't want to get knocked out.
No, he doesn't want... He's going to avoid that left hand. He's going to hit him, smash him with that straight right hand, step to the side.
You think early on?
He'll just pop, yeah. He'll pop shot the shit out of him.
Yeah, he's just going to... I'm telling you, man.
The first two rounds, people are like, holy fuck, did Conor... You think Conor won that round? That I'm telling you, first two rounds are going to be like that. And as it goes on, Floyd's going to start taking over a little more, but he's not going to knock him out. But those first like four rounds, I'm like, oh, fuck, we got some. Watch. People are like, this is weird, man. Mm. Like, he's not doing that bad. Do you give him a round? Fucking Sean was right. Max Kellerman owes him $100,000. This is fucking nuts. Sean's a genius. Oh my God. You guys should go suck his dick. Let's do it. That's how that's going to go down.
Hey, so Tony, if you bet $100, you'll win $2,500. If you bet for that round, Floyd Mayweather wins. So that's what it is.
Oh, I mean, them's good odds.
Oh yeah, Floyd plus. Oh, round. I thought he's minus $2,500.
Oh no, these are just bets for us. So for if Floyd wins by a knockout or whatever, or wins
in the first round,
in round one,
yeah,
and you bet $100, and you win $2,500 bucks. But what are the odds?
Well, what's that odds? Happen? Floyd on points 130. What's that?
Where's it at?
Floyd to win on points plus 130.
Yeah, how much we
so
get?
So if you bet 100, you get 130 back.
Right. All right.
Waste your goddamn time. If you want to win any money, you have to bet.
That's the most likely outcome, I think.
Yeah, well, that's why the odds are fucking like that. What else you got, Chin?
I think that's pretty much it. You guys covered a lot of the stuff we had.
Did we?
Yeah, we did these already.
Yeah, everyone's trying to jump on it. And I love how, I love how the media is like, this is ridiculous. But then again.
The media will love it.
Yeah.
They'll love it.
This is the worst time in sports. You have. Bullshit baseball, which, come on, let's get real. No football. Basketball just ended. July is a big time for MMA. Boxing's good. But in general, this is the dead time in sports. So for Mayweather and fucking McGregor be fighting, it's all that. What else are they going to fucking talk about? What are you going to talk about? LeBron James and the free agency of the Golden State Warriors? Fuck you guys. They should be bowing down to this fight being announced. It gives them content. The ratings are never going to be higher because everyone wants to get these terrible breakdowns of the fight.
Yeah.
And these guys know what the fuck they're talking about. My issue is these guys are framing the minds of uneducated people who are new to the sport. They're framing the wrong kind of information. That's when I have an issue with it. Because if you don't know what you're talking about, don't fucking talk about it.
Right.
I'm not going two balls deep on the exact technique of Floyd Mayweather
because
I'm not an expert in that. I am an expert in mixed martial arts, Conor McGregor, though.
Right. Yeah.
I would like to find out, Chin, if you can get it up there, the price of the tickets, because someone posted this online, the price of the tickets, and the cheapest tickets in the fucking bleachers was like $1,000.
I bet.
Really?
Oh, 100%.
I heard it's going to be more than that.
I heard it's going to be more than that.
And I heard that you have to know someone to even get an option to buy the tickets.
Wow.
I mean, fucking hell.
I know a guy. I got a call yesterday if I'm good. I'm hoping I'm working the fight. Might be going to it. If I'm not, that'd be cool.
So, do you
sell the fuck out of that ticket?
Do you know much about the deal with the UFC and Conor?
We don't know. We know Conor's scheduled to make over 100 million. Both guys are.
But what does the UFC get? No one
good
knows.
Question.
Doesn't he still have four fights left on his UFC?
But this
contract?
Is completely outside, so this is a separate deal,
right?
So that who knows? But I also think this shows you the state that the UFC's in. Obviously, boxing, you know, they're down for this because it's all in their favor. But for the UFC, you know, 6 years ago, Anderson Silva wanted to fight Roy Jones.
Yeah.
And it, and Dana was like, what? Get the fuck, that ain't happening. And they were both kind of in their prime then. They were both, that'd been a much,
yeah,
that'd been a ridiculous fight. But they wouldn't even entertain it. Now, you know, the UFC, you know, they have this big nut. Connor's this big, you know, star. They need to, it's been a down year. We haven't really had anything to blow the fans' hair back. We need some sort of major announcement.
Yeah.
So I think that this is a perfect time where the UFC goes, we kind of got our hands tied here. We need to do something. Because 4 years ago, before they sold, if Fertitta's run this bitch, you're not, there's no way this fight were going to happen.
Wasn't the talk about that fight being on the undercard with Roy Jones and Anderson Silva of this? I'm sure I heard that.
Oh, no, Roy Jones wanted it.
Anderson Silva, no. I thought he was tweeting out and all, having a bit.
I think they both did, but then you got a shit show.
That's what I was supposed to say.
If you have other MMA and boxing, then you got a pure shit show. The undercard, they're supposed to announce some big undercard too.
Yeah.
There's one, I heard that, like, there's supposed to be a big announcement on the undercard. Because think, if you're on the undercard of this, it's a big deal.
Oh, massive, yeah. Huge.
Why not put Triple G Canelo on the undercard?
Yeah.
They'll probably make more money doing that one.
So, that's the...
So this is for the Pacquiao Mayweather card. If people that were connected to MGM had an average, they could actually get the lowest ticket price of $5,215 per ticket, all the way up to $11,000.
Imagine paying that for that ticket.
For ringside.
And that fight fucking sucked.
Yeah.
That was terrible.
One of the worst fights of the century.
Yeah. When we were in Vegas for that fight, we couldn't find anywhere
to pay. What did we pay? Like $250, $300 just to get into a nightclub to watch it on a screen.
Here's the other thing. Do we know how much the pay-per-view is going to be for Conor Floyd? I heard it's supposed to be $130.
They should.
Because Pacquiao Mayweather was $100, right? The most expensive at $100. I heard it's supposed to be $129.99. That's a rumor. I can't confirm that, but that's what I heard.
So the rumor is $3,000 to get in the door. And average tickets of $6,500 for the McGregor Mayweather.
That's going
to
go up,
so too. Yeah, $3,000 to get in the door. Does that not get you a ticket? So
That's if you have connections.
Right. Shit, that's fucking crazy. I would rather watch it on TV.
Me too.
At your house on that big lovely sofa.
Me too. I'd much rather have that. I'd rather be working it, to be honest.
Yeah, I bet.
I'd be working like, I'm here, I fucking told you. I told you, Tony. Max Kellerman, suck my dick. Give me my $100,000. I just cuts out. Cussing. I fucking took, sweating, ties all loose. You moron. You dinosaur boxing moron. Just cuts off.
You never get any work ever again.
Never. Just done. Just done. Except for the big round breakdown. Never seen on TV.
But you made $100,000
again.
Off Kellerman.
Hell yeah.
Probably $100,000 off your ticket sales.
Hell yeah. I got this. Like, well, that was interesting. He's obviously has brain trauma. So he did call it, though. We'll give him that. You will never see him again on Showtime. That's it, Chin.
One more thing. So if it does get released to the public, they estimate it to be $13,000 for the ticket. So the average person would pay $13,000 to get
the
in.
The average purse doesn't go $13,000.
Biggest fight of our life, man. That's what, that's what it does.
Yeah, fuck that. I'd rather watch it on your sofa and get
food. Me too. Some free food. When we have our boy fucking cook up some food.
Yeah. What's his name? Figure that out.
Or
who?
The Asian fella.
Oh, Terrence.
Terrence.
Yeah. Fucking get Terrence on there. We're on his house.
That was nice. His dog took a shit under the couch. yeah, man. Well... Yeah, I feel like we had to get this out there before other people pick up on it or other people get their voice out. But the big issue I have with this entire fight is if you tune into these mainstream shows who are uneducated about mixed martial arts and especially Conor McGregor, and they just keep shitting on this fight and they're carving kind of the storyboard of this huge fight and shitting on it, I can't have that. And that's why I'm here.
That's exactly what they're doing, though. They've just got an agenda. They're just trying to paint a picture for you without any real knowledge.
But when Dan Lebatard's like, this, you guys are being hoodwinked. This is a shit fight. That's because they have nothing else going on. Shut the fuck up.
Yeah,
I think he's a baseball guy or something, Miami guy. You don't know what he's talking about. But you need someone who actually knows what they're talking about, mm-hmm. man. This is not the circus that everyone's trying to tell you. There's a reason this fight came to fruition. There's a reason, man.
There was a funny clip of Mayweather just when he was over in England. He's going, that guy, Jim... Lamplay, whatever, like pretending to not know his name. He's like, they know fuck all about boxing. They know nothing
That's
about
hilarious.
Boxing.
Mate. Well, because these old boxing heads, they're like offended.
Oh, yeah.
Like our sacred boxing. You hate to tell you. I mean, boxing's great right now. There's a lot of matchups, but this is the best thing happening to you guys in forever.
Yeah.
Because no one's better at marketing. There's not a better person in the world at promoting the fight than Dana White. There's not a better fighter in the world until Muhammad Ali, until Conor McGregor came around. McGregor is way better at selling fights than anyone in boxing.
Than Mayweather?
Way better.
Oh, well, because his fights are more exciting, right?
Yeah, they're better, and he calls it. He goes, I'm not this guy in the first round. When's the last time Floyd Mayweather goes, I'm going to finish this guy? You don't say any of that. You know what? You know what I'm going to do to you, bro? I'm going to take you 12 rounds. Good luck hitting me.
Would you see him? Because boxing's in a real good place right now, right?
Great.
Would you say it's in a better position than the UFC? Because the UFC is not.
UFC's not in a great spot right now.
It's terrible.
With the sale and the new owners, they don't have to tell the fighters stories. Our biggest stars fighting boxing right now. The other guys, it's this turmoil. They're not good at marketing. They're trying to figure out their way. They're looking at like a used car where they're just trying to flip it and make a profit. It's in a very weird time.
Who's the biggest star in UFC right now, apart from
Conor McGregor?
Apart from Conor?
John Jones.
Yeah, he's
just got done doing lines and running into pregnant girls. Like, and he got suspended, and now he's fighting in July.
But then who? Because I think he's only got one fight left, or two fights left. John Jones.
That's a great question.
Is it Cody
Garbrandt?
Yeah.
You know, he's not a crossover superstar. No, he's amazing, and he has the skills, and he has the potential. But as far as stars, we got no one. Our heavyweight champ, Stipe. You know, no one would know him if you walked down the street. I love Stipe. But,
yeah, he's a great fighter. But
at light heavyweight, you know, Daniel Cormier, not a draw. No. At Bisping, you got Bisping at middleweight.
Yeah.
Again,
he's coming to the end as well.
And then at 55, you know, you got Tony Ferguson. You got Khabib, neither one of them a draw. At 45, you got Max Holloway, who's Hawaiian, who just got the belt. Not a big draw. At 35, you got Cody Garbrandt. And at 125, you got DJ Johnson. And then for the women, you got Joanna Jędrzejczyk. You guys know who she is?
Yeah.
Exactly. Glenn does not. And then you got Cyborg at 45. At 35, you got kind of a shit show with Amanda Nunes and Jermaine Geronimi.
So
there's not a lot of stars here.
It's in a bad position right now.
I think that's why this fight is happening.
That was my point.
That's the reason Dana's gone.
Like everything worked out exactly where the UFC's in this weird turmoil. Yeah. You know, Floyd Mayweather, he's 40 and he's retired, and then you got Conor, this mega star. It literally everything happened for this.
But this is not going to help the UFC at all. How is it?
This actually hurts him in the long run because Conor's gonna be fat and happy.
Even if Conor did, which he's not going to knock him out, then. It's not going to help the UFC.
No. It's kind of saying like, well,
it helps Dana White.
UFC's in
he manufactures this deal. I'm sure he has.
So he's getting a lump of cash, but then the UFC
Dana has $400 million in the bank, and he's the one who manufactured this fight.
Right.
So he goes down as we already know he's one of the best promoters in the game and in history. You know, you got Don King, you got Al Heyman, and now you got Dana White because he's the one who manufactured the biggest sporting event in sports history.
Yeah.
He was the A side of this. Right. So that's what he's in for. You're looking at egos now.
It's almost like by him letting this happen, he's almost admitting that we need Floyd Mayweather or boxing to do anything, to keep going. You know?
We're in a little bit of turmoil. Yeah. But just like anything, like you need superstars and it's their job to tell a story. There's no one right now with that Conor McGregor magic, you know, like.
But even
there hasn't been a Muhammad Ali in boxing forever. Like, take out, you know, boxing's great skill wise, but personality. Let's just go through the top five. Lomachenko doesn't speak English. Yeah. I love Lomachenko. Doesn't speak English. Tiny.
Right.
Dime piece looking dude doesn't speak English from Lithuania, right? Doesn't speak
Ukraine,
English.
Yeah.
Number two, you got Andre Ward. He's busy praying and not talking. So you got him. Huge fight this weekend. Might break 200 pay per views. Doubt it. Number three, you got Gennady Golovkin.
Same as Lomachenko.
Really doesn't speak English. Not great, right? Not a crossover.
Yeah.
Number four, you got Terrence Crawford. Chin, you ever heard of Terrence Crawford? Exactly. Yeah. So you got Terrence Crawford from Nebraska who just won. No one watched.
Yeah.
Number five, you got Canelo.
Well, you missed someone.
And that's
Anthony Joshua.
That's why boxing fans are...
Top 10. Anthony Joshua is huge, right?
Yeah.
He's
the biggest star
in
boxing right now.
No, Canelo still is.
Oh, yeah, Canelo. And then him. Right,
but there's argument. I thought Anthony Joshua was the biggest. Now he's heavyweight.
He's more marketable,
he
isn't he?
He just beat Klitschko. How many people watched that fight?
Yeah,
he's a mega star in England.
He's a massive, but also he's not a personality, is he?
Not really.
Joshua.
Not like a Tyson Fury.
Oh yeah, that's right. That's right.
Like if I could take Tyson Fury's charisma and put in Anthony Joshua, you got something.
Yeah. Do you know why?
Conor McGregor boxing.
Do you know why Anthony Joshua is as huge as he is? Is because he's with Matchroom, who's the biggest boxing promoter in England, and they've got Sky Sports, the biggest platform. So because he's done so well in the ring and he's let his fighting talk, and he's got that huge, massive budget and marketing behind him with Matchroom and Sky, that's, I think, the main reason why he's elevated to that superstar level.
But he's also knocking everyone out.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. That's number one.
Oh, yeah, he's definitely.
Otherwise, you got nothing.
No, yeah, he's definitely let his boxing
talk. Not to mention, he looks like a Greek goddess.
Right, yeah, yeah.
I'm not gay, but I'm like... We'll figure it out, man.
He definitely lets his fighting do the talking, but I'm saying a huge part of it is what's behind him. Look at Tyson Fury. He went and let his fighting do the talking. He went and knocked Klitschko out in Germany.
True.
Nobody gave a shit because he's not with Matchroom and he's not on Sky.
That's crazy because he's more marketable.
Exactly.
He should be more marketable
point.
Than Joshua.
You think Fury's more marketable? He looked, but
he's controversial as fuck. He's funny
as
fuck.
Did you not see when
he speaks so what he funny. Speaks
when
his
he
mind?
Took his shirt off in that
it's
press
so
conference
funny.
And he's like, get back on his bed.
It's so funny.
Yeah, he's so marketable. It's so funny.
Yeah.
But, you know?
Yeah, when after Joshua beat Klitschko, I was like, God, you look at the numbers, you know, there's argument he's the biggest star.
But you know, what are you going to do? Like, when you're talking about who's more marketable, are you going to put Tyson Fury on the cover of GQ with his belly out? Or are you going to put fucking
I would, but
chiseled
yeah,
Anthony Joshua on the cover of GQ?
Yeah,
we would. We would. But, like, you know, they're selling that to, like,
see, I feel like more people can relate to Tyson Fury than Anthony Joshua.
Right.
I feel like more people go, God, he looks like a normal fucking dude.
Right.
He's 6'8". Yeah. He looks like a normal fucking dude.
Yeah.
He has mental health issues. He comes from the fucking shrubs. He's a traveler.
Yeah.
I told you I had a guy get in my face because I went, yeah, he's a crazy gypsy. He's like, traveler. I'm like, yeah, we call him gypsies here. He's like, traveler. I thought we were going to fight.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's that offends them. Unless you're a traveler, you can't call them a gypsy.
Yeah, it's like using the N-word. Unless you're black, right. You can't. I did not know that.
Yeah.
I only use traveler now. But I appreciate you guys coming on, man.
Thanks
I thought
for
this
us.
Was important. You guys know boxing.
Thank
like
you.
I
love that. This was fun, man. It was another good one.
This was really fun. What do you guys got going on? Plug whatever you got going on right now.
Straight back to the gym.
Straight back to the gym.
Day
you got,
day
you got
out.
Any certifications
Yeah, we're
coming
doing up? A certification in July 9th in Santa Monica. It's just about sold out. So this is
at the Box and Burn Santa Monica?
Yeah. Yeah.
Brilliant.
This is where Brendan trains every day, so come and see that. And that's
I'll
where
be there with my shirt off.
That's where we teach trainers, personal trainers, how to teach boxing.
So they can add boxing into their repertoire.
We've just been on it. We certified all our honor trainers.
You guys are always that honor these days.
We're killing it. Weekend we've done over 85 people certified them. And then the weekend before we're in Orlando with another 35 people.
So you go to Santa Monica, anywhere scheduled after that or no?
And then we go to Denver. Oh, your place with Denver?
You're going to Lauren Landau and Amalia and all the guys,
and Cody.
Oh, shit.
Well, you kind of settled up for me.
Yeah.
And then you said you want to help us promote. So we've got time for that one.
Denver's in August.
Oh yeah, we got time.
Then we got San Jose
it's
in October.
It's on August
26th, well.
Right?
I think so.
No, it's not.
Shit. I was like, yeah, we just talked about this.
Yeah. Yeah. So in Denver.
So Santa Monica, Denver,
San Jose, and then I mean next year we want to follow your footsteps and go to Australia, go over there because there's a big market in Sydney and Melbourne for personal trainers.
Get to England too.
Yeah, we're
talking Birmingham.
I think it would be
England,
fun
London.
If we were in England at the same time.
Yeah, it'd be great.
Let's sort it out.
We
want
should
to do that. Yeah.
They're trying to figure out dates now. We should figure it out.
Yeah.
Definitely going to Sunderland, but we'll figure it out.
Yeah, don't go there. We'll go to...
And then they can... yours is at Glenn Holmes LA, right?
Yeah.
And then you're just at Tony Jeffries.
Tony _ Jeffries.
Boom. Someone stole your shit.
Yeah.
That's the worst. And at Box and Burn. You guys can find Box and Burn. It's in Santa Monica, the best gym in the world. I am Brendan Schaub. I will be in Long Beach, California, July 27th. Next week, I am in New York. That show is already sold out. I'm in Phoenix on July 18th. I think it's the 20th. July 20th, I'm at Stand Up Live in Phoenix, Arizona. I got a bunch of dates coming up where I am breaking this fight down, balls deep, slanging jokes. Stay tuned for that. Thank you guys for listening to this bonus episode of the Big Brown Breakdown featuring Conor McGregor and Floyd Mayweather with my good friends Glenn Holmes and Tony Jeffries. As usual, bigger, browner, badder. I'm Brendan Schaub. We're out.